Welcome to another exciting broadcast day.
Yes, it's true. 866-901-ADAMS, the phone number. We'd like to hear from you. Well, let's see. We have a surprise guest today. I'm nervous because Jimmy set it up. And there's no good surprises with Jimmy. There's only bad surprises.
I gave you a clue. Someone from your past.
Thank you. It's not a time traveler from the future that I would recognize immediately. Someone from the past. That's my problem.
That's as many, much of a clue I'm going to give you.
Yeah, and I realize, I guess it's an interesting test because it's one of those things where if a lot of people said, hey, somebody from your past is going to come visit you, half the world would go, holy F, and the other half would go, fantastic, I can't wait, who's it going to be? I'm definitely in the holy F side of the crowd. But I'm the same way when the phone rings. Phone rings, I'm like Dave Damashek over here. The phone rings and it's like, who could that be? Could be someone good, probably not. Could be someone bad, not going to answer the phone.
Either way, they want to tell me stuff about themselves.
Right.
Listen, I've been down that path.
It's
before.
A bold way to travel through life. Yeah. It really is. Yeah. Lisa Arch is here. Lisa is a dear, 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 dear old friend of mine. She's filling in for Rachel today. Lisa is was a series regular on Mad TV. Also, forgot about this, co-hosted Dinner and a Movie and Cammy on Crank Yankers. I'll tell you, I'll tell you something sad and pathetic that most men do not want to admit. They can be turned on by animation and puppetry. I mean, they really can. I mean, whenever I see Drawn Together, it was on last night on Comedy Central, an animated show I do, and Foxy Love shows up with the big cans and the tight ass. It's titillating. It's a drawing.
I could see that, though.
Cammy's puppet.
Cammy's hot.
Cammy is, like, busty and blonde and beautiful, and I used to look at the puppet and get excited.
Now, maybe she's a redhead, by the way.
Oh, redhead, yeah.
As an executive producer on that show, you never took any liberties after hours in the warehouse where
I would take some of the puppets out once in a while, like on a weekend. Spoonie Love and I would go out, you know, see if we could turn out some bitches or something like that. And every once in a blue moon, Cammy would spend the evening. But it was totally professional, just going over some of the beats from the next call session.
You're a pro.
Also, Susan B. Anthony from Windy City Heat. I forgot your name was Susan B. Anthony. Those of you who have not seen Windy City Heat need to find it and see it. I don't know what else to say about it.
Is that ever coming out on DVD?
I don't know, but, you know, I'm officially labeling Windy City Heat, the show we did for Comedy Central. It was a movie we did for Comedy Central. It's the funniest thing seen by the least people. There's a weird quotient, I imagine, and I'm trying to think of the funniest or least funniest seen by the most. Do you know what I mean?
There's
probably some Steve Martin movie like My Blue Heaven or something, or whatever that one where he had to be a suburban. He was like a gangster.
That got mafia. Right.
Yeah, I'm trying to think. We should find a list. It'd be an interesting thing to find out.
I got one for you. Dana Carvey show in the 90s. It aired for 5 or 6 episodes. Had some of the best writers of all time in it. Steve O'Donnell of The Simpsons and Seinfeld. No one saw it.
Nobody saw it, but it was hysterical. Arguably, 20-fold as many as seen Windy City Heat.
Yes. But I've been recognized more for Windy City Heat than for anything else that
I've
done. Yeah, so the people
who should kill yourself. That's so horrible. That says horrible things about the way your career's been going,
Well,
Lisa.
That's true, but my point being that people love the movie so much that they actually approach me because they loved it so
much. Well, interesting. But it would be, I mean, and like I said, well, the movie has my name on it, but I didn't star in it. I was a cameo that lasted 1.5 minutes. I claim no artistic, I need no artistic points on it. I didn't help write it. I did barely anything on it. I'm just get to be one of the producers on it. Now, I would feel foolish saying this is the funniest movie ever made. I wrote every word that's on the screen. I would feel stupid saying that. I feel because I'm distanced from it creatively that I can say I've seen it, I've watched it objectively, and no funnier movie and no less eyeballs have seen it.
Decade of work by Don Barris, Tony Barbieri.
That's right.
Hopefully
we'll get it out on DVD soon and you folks can go see it. Also, we were talking to Lisa before the show about her maiden name and changing her name and going with her married name. And I know her as Lisa Kuschel. Mm-hmm. You don't mind me saying that. And I've known Lisa since 18 or 19. How old were you?
I think I was 18.
18. Imagine this, a foxy Lisa Arch over here at 19, running around my backyard in a bikini.
Yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah.
How old were you?
I was 41. No, I was, I'm trying to do the math, you know. I guess I'm 10 years older than Lisa or something like that. How old are you now?
I'm 34 now.
Oh, 34. See, this is how it works. I'm 6 or 7 years older than Lisa, but it seemed like the biggest chasm in the world when she was 18 or 19 and I was 24, 25. It's like, well, I'm too old.
Forbidden fruit, right?
Forbidden fruit.
Although I think back then you said things to me like, you're so much older than your age.
Mm.
I'm pretty sure.
You've I'll got an that. Old soul.
I'll do
and
that.
A beautiful rack.
Yes, yes. Yeah. You want me to buy you some beer? I have a real ID. Yeah, well, here's the thing about Lisa, and I mean, here's why she should drive any man mad. Amazingly funny, amazingly talented, because I met her over at Acme Theater, does all the voices and the characters and everything. And I don't know how many 18 or 19-year-old ladies or gents you find that are really that accomplished in sketch improv comedy at age 18 or 19. It's one of these things, and there's certain things that are this way. It's like airplane pilot. There's no good commercial airplane pilots that are 14, 17 years old, and you wouldn't get on that flight. There's no good heavyweights, with the rare exception of a Mike Tyson. They're like 18 years old. It's one of these things. Sketch comedy is one of these things. Improvisational comedy is one of these things where you come into your own around 31, 32. That's just, you've been around, you've seen enough, you have your references, you have your point of view. For some reason, Lisa was amazing at age 18 or 19 and then looked amazing in her bikini running around in my backyard. So Aww. It was a crazy combination.
Unfortunately, I peaked on both levels at that time.
No.
That was my best bikini body and my best comedy.
I'm sizing you up. I still think you look pretty good. But we had a pool. We're the only ones with a pool. We rented a house, me and three guys.
Oh, I was confused. I was thinking somehow the Corollas had a pool. That couldn't be.
Sometimes water would puddle in the uneven driveway. And my dad technically counted that as one. But no, I would keep telling him, garbage can does not count as a basketball hoop, Pops. No, and the puddling in the driveway where the mosquito larva is festering. No, that is not a dipping. That's not a lap pool. Mm-mm. No, we rented a house in La Crescenta that had a pool. And the folks would congregate over in the backyard.
That's awesome.
We would have parties over there. And we would party as only 20, you know, as only guys in their mid to late 20s who really had no car insurance, no health insurance, no family to watch over them, and no real life ambitions could do. Like, it was debauchery. We didn't make any apologies either. It was like, look, we're in our 20s. No one has any money. Life is not going according to plan, but we're going to have a good time on Saturday.
Yeah, you feel like you're cheating life if you're in your 20s. I lived in Chicago for my 20s. Going to the ballgame, getting loaded and everything. You feel, because like you look around at your peers and you say, well, some of them have kids and, you know, a wife at home. Like, I get the swing, you know, you live it up.
Plus, we were all actors, so the love was free-flowing.
Well, Lisa, you were the... So a lot of people out here in L.A. do these acting classes and stuff, and there's always... Every guy says, oh, you should do it, because there's always one fox in the class.
Yes.
You were the fox.
I don't know about that.
Yeah, she was the fox. Yes.
Oh, at Acme. Maybe I was one of maybe a few foxes.
Yeah, if you're going to do the acting thing, what you want to do is take an acting class, just like if you're going to go to one of the A... meetings, like, you know, the Alcoholic Anonymous meeting. You want to go to the CA meeting in West Hollywood. That's where all the foxes are, a bunch of skinny blondes that got strung out. You don't want to go to OA in Northridge.
No.
You don't go to the Overeaters Anonymous out in Northridge. They're both end with an A. They're both the same, basically. They're the same type of thing, but they vary quite a bit. So what you're going to want to do, if you're coming out and you want to meet foxes, you take an acting class. Or you take a beginning improv class, because all the hotties never make it to the next level, with the exception of Lisa Arch, as we now know her. You know what I'm saying?
Sure.
They get funneled out, right? But you will find a ton. And actually, this is a better way to go. All right. Here's what you should do. you take a beginning improv class out here in Los Angeles, go to the Groundlings, go to Acme Theater, go wherever you got to go, the very basic beginning class, tons of foxy chicks who are hot actress types whose agents told them to take an improv class that would help them in the audition process. Now, they're not funny, and they're never going to make it to the next level, but they think you're funny, and if you're funny, no matter what you look like, you could be the hot dude in the class because you're the funny guy in that class. Now, if you just take an acting class, you're just the good-looking guy that's in the class with the other good-looking soap guys. See what I'm saying?
Sure.
All right, that's the strategy.
And if they're failures in the comedy business, you know, they try this and the teacher says, you're not going to move on to the next episode. Now they're emotionally fragile.
Mm-hmm.
Now you pounce.
You sweep in. Yes.
Not only that, most of the dumb girls in the improv class will immediately want to play a stripper or a prostitute.
Yes.
And
yeah.
That'll be helpful.
It works.
For you.
It's a go-to thing. Same way for Halloween, they dress up as Playboy bunnies and stuff. It's a it's a go-to thing. All right, so we welcome Lisa, who's going to be doing the news and chiming in all day today. Tim McGraw is going to be calling in. Also, we have more from our Zacharias Moussaoui trial tape. American Idol cast off, not Mandisa last night, but Lisa Tucker. We're a week late, so be it. We have a surprise guest, which I said before makes me very nervous, and Joel McHale from Talk Soup, very funny. I was just watching it the other night, and I was thinking to myself, hey, this is funny. It's weird. It's so sad when you watch this creative state is so bad that sometimes when you're flipping through radio stations and you hear a song and you go, oh, this song doesn't suck. Yes, it's on the radio. It should be a decent song, but you're so jaded because everything is so horrible. Same with TV. When you watch anything that's presented as funny, every 456 shows, you go, oh, hey, wait a minute. Look at my face. It's smiling. Wait, my mouth is open. Laughter's come out. What's going on here? Hold on. I must be looking at me. No, it's somebody else, and he's funny. This is amazing. Yeah, that's the way I felt watching Talk Soup. I know it sounds narcissistic, but you just don't. I actually thought about, hey, this is funny. Yes, it's supposed to be. It's what they do.
Sad state that entertainment is in.
Very sad. And dear friend, speaking of racks, Mimi Rogers, she's sassy. I know her. She's coming in. So we'll talk to her, Joel,
you know
everyone.
Her.
Well, it's one of these things where, you know, we got to go to break, but I'll just say very quickly. When I used to do Loveline, the radio show, people would come in and they would hang out for 2 hours and they would just sort of open themselves up. It was like sitting next to somebody on a 2-hour plane flight at night when they'd had a few cocktails. Sometimes people would come in, they'd be a little lubricated because some folks hit the sauce a little bit at 10 o'clock at night, you know, a couple glasses of wine. And they sit in a small dark room and it's just like you and them and they just start talking and they just start opening up. And Dr. Drew would be sitting there and they would just open up and just start talking. And at the end of the 2 hours, it was like, hey, you know, it wasn't as if they sat next to you on the sofa and you were filling in for Craig Ferguson or something and they were going to do a well-planned 4-minute set and then skedaddle where you barely even got to know them. It was really intimate. And at the end, it'd be like you're hugging them, hey, and all this. You felt like you knew them. Mm. And then I talked to her on the phone or something at some point. I may have done her. I'm not sure. Like I said, we're all renting a house. It was a different time. All right, we will take ourselves a break. Tim McGraw will be here next. Mm-hmm. Tim McGraw's coming up. I guess I knew his dad was Tug McGraw, baseball great, but I'm not sure if I thought about it.
Sure, they came back together after years apart, I think. Or
oh, really?
Like that. Yeah, and then his father was sick and died a year or two ago, but yeah.
Yeah.
Sad Tug. Yarn. But Tug, dynamite name. Sure.
Also, yeah, I got to say, no, I don't want to offend Tim if he's listening, but Tim, quite a step down from Tug.
Sure.
Both three letters, both start with a T, but you go from Tug to Tim.
Now, listen, maybe
step backwards in my department.
Maybe you should add that one to the list of baby names.
Tug Carolla.
Tug Carolla
is.
Ooh, that's good.
I like it.
Tug is good, yeah. It's going to be some masturbation jokes, I guess, if you name your kid Tug.
You can't get down about that. The
really?
Kids will figure out a way to make fun of everyone's name. We could go around the room and the most innocuous
names. Yeah.
Everyone's name will be made fun of.
No, I know, because it's funny. Even a name like Damashek that sounds like, well, what are you going to do with that? Still people around here. It's like, hey, Dave, I suck at doing the sports. Damashek. You know, and I'm like, well, that doesn't really rhyme. I would argue that you could do that with any last name, but they still laugh and shake their head, walk down the hall. Yeah.
But also any Carolla, whether or not his name is Tug, will have masturbation jokes.
I guess there's a legacy there.
Yeah.
It's like Hitler's kids. There's going to be
issues.
Absolutely.
Nothing you can do about it.
If he does, in fact, have children. I don't think he did. Maybe his dog was. Jeff?
Yes, sir.
You have a home improvement question?
Yeah, real quick, though. I did rub a few out to Cammie on the...
Yes. Thank you. She was
so
very hot. Yeah.
Braggadocious.
Still is.
It's an honor to be speaking with Cammie. Anywho, water heater, Adam. I'm not getting enough hot water.
Mm-hmm.
Is there anything? I got a 25-gallon water heater.
Yeah.
Man, anything?
That's not real big, but you don't sound like you live in a very big place.
No.
Just going on, playing a hunch here.
Yeah.
Sometimes your water heater, if you live in a big place, is far away from the spigot that the hot water is supposed to come out of. And it takes a while if you think about it. Your bathroom's upstairs. It's in the far side of the house. Maybe your water heater's tucked away in a closet in the garage or the basement or something like that. Things got to travel 120 feet worth of pipe just to get to the spigot. You don't have that problem, though, right, Jeff? But are you a renter or an owner?
I'm an owner. I got a 2-bedroom house.
Where is it?
In the garage.
Your house is in the garage? You must love your house.
Love it. It's, you know how Mexicans do. We
sure. The garage, they put the house in the garage?
Right.
Uh-huh. Sure.
Yeah.
Where's the yard? In the barbecue?
Yeah, in the barbecue.
Where do you keep the car? Hallway, closet? The kids' room? Where's that? That's in one of the French drains. That's in the house. That's in the yard. That's in, I don't know why, the Mexican swallowed the fly.
Yeah.
Okay. So, you know what they do have now? They have tankless water heaters. Okay. Have you heard of these?
No, I haven't.
Everyone ought to get into this. This is a water heater right now. As we speak, as you sit here, all of you guys are wasting energy heating a tub of water. I mean, the way water heaters work is it's essentially just a barrel of water. You set it to a temperature, maybe 100 degrees, 120 degrees. By the way, does restaurant water always have to come out steaming hot? You ever go to a restaurant, wash your hands, and turn the hot water? Most of the time you turn the hot water on because you just figure it's going to take a minute to heat up. I just got to wash it. A puff of smoke comes out and then all of a sudden you run out holding your hand. Ah! Skin bubbling off there. I imagine they jack it up because they're washing dishes, but you're killing the guys in the head with this thing. All right, anyway.
Yes.
Where were we?
It's a problem.
You know, it'd be nice if I had a restaurant. I would run the urinals off the hot water instead of the cold water. You'd flush, and a plume of steam would come up with the smell like urine.
I understand the spirit of that, but yes. I think it might cause some smells.
I disagree. I like that person. Says it three times. Excuse me. I disagree. So, Jeff, how about stepping up to one of those tankless units? Because the thing is, so you have a barrel of water that you heat to 120 degrees. Now, when you go out of town, when you and the old lady go to San Simeon to see Hearst Castle for the weekend, and you leave on Friday, that tub of water is being constantly heated. Flame underneath it, electric coils, whatever you have, it's being constantly kept at that temperature. It's essentially like you putting a big pot of water on your stove and keeping it at a certain temperature. Whether you're at home or not, people go out of town. They go to Europe for 2 weeks. They're still heating that. Sometimes it can explode and rupture and so on and so forth. The tankless water heater heats the water as you need it. No hopper, no tank, hence the name, tankless. It has coils in it, and the water travels through the coils that are heated. So if you need 20 gallons for a shower, you get 20 gallons for a shower. When you shut it off, it's
like
off.
Like a big coffee maker.
Right. Okay. Goes on when you need it, but it doesn't sit there and heat the coffee all day long, even when you're not using it.
And it's a big expense up front, but it ends up saving you money, doesn't it?
You can get rebates, I think, from the energy company because you save a lot, and they're coming down and down in price. I think they're like $300 or $400 now, and getting pretty close to the cost of one, and they don't take up as much room. They're like one of those Soviet suitcase bombs. They're about that size. I could have said attaché case. I could have said Samsonite, but I'm negative. I like to think of a dirty bomb that's being smuggled into this country. They're about that size instead of the size of a, you know, big cylinder. So, Jeff.
Yes.
How about that? Why don't you go to a tankless number?
Where do I get that at?
You can get them. I think you can get them anywhere now, but go online. Do you have a computer?
Yes, I do.
Where's the computer? In the garbage disposal?
In the sink, sorry.
You keep it in the sink, and then the sink is kept where?
Yes.
On your mother?
On my mother next to the kids. You know?
Okay. All right, Jeff.
Thanks, Adam.
Good times, brother. Let's see. One more call. Rich?
Hey, Adam, what's going on, buddy?
I'm intrigued by what it says your question is. Saw you in Lips Incorporated.
I figure you're Mike because we're the same age. I grew up here. I myself a struggling wannabe, but you are a wannabe. Well, no, you actually are now.
Right.
Basically, though, I remember seeing you a long time ago. If I'm not mistaken, it could have been Greg Brady. But it was called Lips Inc., and it was an improv groove in, I think, off Cahuenga or Van Nuys Boulevard. And I was always curious to see if that was actually your group or is that just a group of people that you got together.
There is a troupe on Ventura in Van Nuys, and there's something to do with Lips, but it's not called Lips.
LA Connection?
You're thinking of the LA Connection.
Oh, that's exactly what it was. That was you then, right?
No, it wasn't, because I've never with the LA Connection. It's just between Lisa and I, we can figure it out through our 700 combined years of Valley improv training.
That's
true. Was with the Frayed Knots from 1942 all the way to 87 when I met her.
Well, what about, I'm just curious, Adam, you never really talked about the Angus days. Didn't you and your boys go through Black Angus, that early 20s for like 2 or 3 years when that was basically the only place you could go and get hammered and, you know, afterwards?
No, we had places to get hammered, but, you know, we had different places. We had the underage places we would go to.
Hollywood,
we'd go to Casa Vega, which was a Mexican joint in Studio City. They used to serve underage people back then. You knew the places, you knew the liquor stores. I mean, you had it scouted out. You try to find that liquor store that had the guy behind the counter with the crazy nationality who really could not judge. You know, you really, it's hard to tell. It's like if somebody plays you music from the Middle East and says, is it good or is it bad? What the hell do I know about this stuff? I hear a sitar and a guy blowing something sounds like a kazoo. What the hell do I know? I don't know anything about this. It's that way with age and culture and stuff. I believe if you're from parts unknown, you just take a look at some white guy from the Valley. You don't know if he's in his teens or in his 30s.
It's a weird thing. It's a trade-off for the business owner, though, because then you would never go back to that place once you're legal.
Yeah,
that's for the underage kids. I'm not going to that place. That's
right.
Squares.
Yeah, it's like, why should I go there? Right. And I would do the same. We used to go drink over at Casa Vega. I think they've cleaned things up since. But you knew those places.
Yeah.
It was a simpler time. Or you get somebody to buy you beer. All right. How did we get onto that, by the way? Oh, Lips Incorporated.
I don't know.
I think the thing is it had, on Ventura, the place we were talking about, had a huge mouth or something on it, right?
That doesn't sound familiar,
no.
But maybe.
All right, I'm making that up. So, let's keep on keeping on. We were talking, we're constantly amused with Entertainment Tonight and The Insider and all those kind of shows. And to me, it's the slug lines at the top of the show that are the best. I just watch those and the range they have between what's going on with Mariah Carey and then somebody's tragic losing a breast to cancer. I mean, they're all over the map. And then the other thing I've learned from those shows is when they don't tell you who it is, you've never heard of it. A big celebrity with an eating disorder. Well, the point is if Tom Cruise has an eating disorder, they say Tom Cruise. When they say big celebrity or sitcom star with an eating disorder, you have no idea. You'll swear you've never seen the person before in your life. So what we did is we pulled that. Yes, Dave Damashek?
True. Yes. And by the way, 97% roughly of the Entertainment Tonight / Insider Hour is just promotion for what's coming up. It's just constant. It's this, what you're about to hear, just being teased over and over and over.
The thing that is funny, yes, on Entertainment Tonight, it's like coming up in 26 minutes on the Insider, P.O.B. sitting down with J-Lo.
And he's constantly, I love his little updates when he looks at his watch.
Right. He's like, in 22 minutes 49. Oh, Christ. 22:46. It's coming. Yeah, they do that, and then you realize it's been a half hour of watching promos. Yes,
they also toss to each other like
in the same studio
around the world. But yeah, they're all in the same studio.
Yeah, it's so cagey. You would think watching it that it's two separate shows.
Yeah, someone's in Russia,
but it's
someone's
the same
in New
show.
York.
Just 1 hour, but they present it as though it's two shows. Right. Entertainment Tonight. Now it's time for The Inside.
Laura
it's the same
Spencer's
show.
With Eva Longoria's stepdad on a one-on-one. Yeah. Eva, when's that come? 26 minutes, POV, from now. Synchronize.
That's all it is. What's coming up? Let's hear a little.
I have to sit there and synchronize my watch. Now listen, honey, I'm going to go make number two. Call me, not in 27 minutes. not in 25 minutes, in 26 minutes, I want to find out what's going on with the twins from Australia who have the eating disorder. Yeah, I know. And then you realize you've watched the entire show before The Insider, and all it was a promo. We should do that.
It's genius.
It'd be funny if sitcoms did that. The whole half hour before Two and a Half Men was just, here's what's coming up on Two and a Half Men.
Yeah.
That'd be the sitcom I'd want to be on.
It's sort of like your movie idea of putting the team together, and that's the whole movie. The whole movie is devoted to putting the team back together.
Yes, I had a movie, an action movie, where we had to get the team back together. We had to get Charlie, the best second story man in the business. We had to get the beautiful knife thrower. We had to get the demolition man. We had, but unfortunately, it took too long, and we never did get to the caper. At the end of the movie, about an hour and 45, it realized we got everyone assembled, but it's like, well, we're kind of out of time. Yeah. Sorry. You guys can go back to your gigs.
Or maybe we'll
do a sequel or something. But, hey, good seeing you.
Take it easy.
Charlie, looking good. No, call him. No, you got my number. No, it's the same.
Three kids now.
Same.
Wow, good
same
for
number.
You. God bless.
I'll give him a call. Yeah, that's old movie. All right, where were we? All right, so let's listen. Now, this is just yesterday's, right?
It's a little bit of yesterday, a little bit of the day before.
Okay.
American Idol gets personal. Simon takes a shot at Ryan's rumored romance with Terry Hatcher.
Meet the author who wants you to believe Jesus survived the crucifixion.
A primetime bride-to-be takes E.T. shopping for bridesmaids' dresses.
A mother with no nose, a daughter with no ears, and the Hollywood genius building them new faces.
Mr. Potato Head.
Last John Travolta interview, why will he be dressing as a woman?
Naked celebrity.
And an all-male catfight.
And caught on tape, Tyra Banks passes out.
Katie makes it official. She's leaving.
Now, did she pass out on tape? Jesus. Or did she see something on tape that made her pass out?
They show her fall down in the thing.
Wow.
She collapses.
Wow. I got to say this about Tyra Banks. I think normally I have a blowhard award I give every year. Mm-hmm. Normally, to fit the criteria, you have to be male. You have to be heavy set. You have to be white. You have to be usually 47 to 61 is good. And say at the end of the day all the time and maybe have a little gin blossom on a nose. You rarely find them in busty, lanky, beautiful women of color. But I'll tell you, Tyra Banks, pound for pound, could give anyone a run in the blowhard department.
Couldn't agree with you more.
She did an entire week on her show on hanging up her angel wings. She hung up her wing. By the way, you retire from professional sports. You don't retire from modeling because there's nothing to do in modeling. Yeah. You know, the day you retire from walking 80 feet, turning around and walking back from whence you came, that's when you have to retire. When you're in a wheelchair, you retire from modeling. You model. You'll just continue. She'll just do. Maybe she won't do anything for Victoria's Secret. But I actually hung the wings up on cables and lifted them. Her mom was crying. She was thanking everybody. It was like the people that. First off, the people that retire from stuff at age 32 and a half. That's a super blowhardy thing. I'm hanging this up.
Well, that's so when she models again in 2 weeks.
Coming out of retirement.
Thank God she's back.
In 22 and a half minutes, POB, what's going on? Tyra's angel's wings returning to Earth and landing on Tyra. Fantastic. I always like this one, too, where they retire and explain it's time to step aside. Make room. as if nobody else could be a model while Tyra was dominating the model world. You see, there's no room for all the other beautiful people. Now that she stepped aside, let someone else have a chance.
I love my favorite thing that she's done on her show so far, as also did Vanessa Minnillo, the Minx, by the way, from the Insider Entertainment Tonight, whichever one. They both got dressed up in the fat suit to experiment to see how society treats them differently. It's so condescending to everybody else. See, you know, look, one day people come up to men will help me with directions places, but when I'm in the fat suit, people just walk right by me. It's so hard. Yeah, you get to take the makeup off, lady, and then you get to return to being a fox. What about the fat people that you're patronizing?
Plus, these people, the budget to turn them from super fox into super fat is $79 in a trip over to the Rite Aid. So it's not only are they fat, but there's a prosthetic piece of their chin that's peeling off under the hot
scary,
lights.
Right?
And it's like, and it was like, I couldn't get the time of day for men. You looked grotesque. They thought you were an undercover cop or something.
You had leprosy,
Right. Like, but I mean, look, could you imagine what you know, they do it with lights and cameras and angles and everything. But when you're sitting across a table from somebody, you're going out to eat with somebody in broad daylight, you're sitting at an outdoor cafe, you're 36 inches away from their face, I can tell if the guy's got a rogue nasal hair. I can see if the guy's got a blackhead from that distance. By the way, Dave, I want to talk to you during the break. The point is when you have a bunch of, you know, you have three sea sponges hot glued to your face with a ton of base, makeup, paint, you know, and a guts and a fat bra and everything. Like, the person must be sitting across from us. It's like, holy hell, what the hell is going on here? Is this person actually fat or did they make themselves?
I better keep moving just in case she touches me and I catch what she's got. Yeah.
Yeah. Yes, she has like vitiligo or something. There's something, you know, that's what people are freaked out about.
Really, it just makes you understand what people who walk around with putty on their faces feel like every day.
That's a better experiment. Right. Yes, these are what the people with the prosthetic faces have to go through on a daily basis, not the heavyset people. Jesus Christ.
I'll tell you the best thing in that little clip.
By the way, it's the same one where they go from black to white and vice versa.
Oh, yeah.
There's nothing creepier than seeing one of the Wayans brothers in a blonde wig.
Never works.
Weird contacts and stuff. The person, you just must be staring at them going, holy F, what is going on? Is this an actual human being?
Well, the entire premise of the fantastic movie Soul Man, starring C. Thomas Howell, where he becomes a black man with a huge white man nose.
Yeah,
everyone buys it. The best thing though was I liked on that clip we go from Travolta dressing like a woman, Travolta dressing like a woman, and did Jesus survive the crucifixion? I like Mary Hart weighing in on what happened at the crucifixion.
Yes, biblical scholar Mary Hart with her $1 million legs, she's going to weigh in on this. Interpret the, we have a Dead Sea Scroll. We're going to need you, it's in Aramaic. We need you to peruse it, memorize it, and then feed it back to us in a language we can understand, Mary, in 21 minutes. Scares me, people yelling what time stuff's coming up all the time. All right, we will take ourselves a break. Tim McGraw, theoretically, is going to be calling in. We'll get him on the phone. Also, Zacharias Massawi. He's at trial. We have another exclusive audio release from the trial. American Idol cast off Lisa Tucker. Surprise guest, which makes me nervous. Joel McHale from Talk Soup. And actress Mimi Rogers coming in. All still coming up.
He said I was finally the husband. Most of the time I wasn't.
Tim McGraw is on the line. We'll talk to him. He's got a special on NBC coming up tomorrow night, 8 o'clock. Tim McGraw, Reflected. Tim?
Yes.
Thank you for coming on the show.
My pleasure.
Where are you calling from, Tim?
I am calling from Starstruck Studios in Tennessee.
Now, what goes on over there? Music?
At Starstruck, I think they got like where you can do satellite stuff for TV and they record some things here. Reba owns the studio, Reba McEntire.
Really?
Yeah.
I haven't decided whether I'm attracted to her or not. You into her?
I've known Reba for years.
Really?
Yeah.
Who the hell names their kid Reba, by the way?
Well, I guess that's a real Oklahoma, Texas name there.
No, it is. And speaking of good...
Face dad calls her Reber.
Speaking of good names, your dad, Tug McGraw. That is a hell of a name.
I know it.
Was he born a Tug McGraw, or was he a Francis Tug McGraw?
It was Frank Edwin.
Wow, pretty close to Francis.
close to Francis, but it was Frank Edwin, but his mom, when he was breastfeeding, he tugged real hard, I think, is where his name came from.
Really?
So his mom started calling him Little Tugger.
You know, it's weird. I have twins on the way in a couple months, and I'm dying to give the kids a good nickname, but you can't really just hand them a nickname. They have to earn it.
But
maybe I'll set up things for the kid in order to earn the nickname. Start yanking on your mom's boobie.
Yeah,
come on.
Yanker.
Yeah, go ahead and bite down. We'll call you Nibbler. So, Tim, you're out with your beautiful wife, Faith Hill, on tour. And I know you're going to say it's a delight and it's fantastic. But to me, going on the road would be the greatest thing, without my wife, by the way, would be the greatest thing that ever happened to my marriage. You know what I mean? A couple months out of the year, just you and the guys.
I get that every now and then. But you know, most of the time when we're touring anyway, even when she's not, because she hasn't toured, I guess in 6 years since the last time that we did this tour together.
Mm-hmm.
They're usually out with me anyway. So.
Oh, they go out with you anyway. They go in the bus, and you go first class now, right?
Well, absolutely, man. Are you kidding?
Yeah, you mean you have the fancy tour bus? You fly ahead on the plane, all that good stuff, right?
All that good stuff. Absolutely, do it right.
Did you have years when you just hit the road in a van, slept in it?
Oh my God, yeah. In fact, my guitar player still has the van that we used. We had an old Ford van and a trailer, and we traveled for years that way.
And you just going from club to club, sleeping in the van?
Exactly. Club to club, sleeping in the van. Every time we'd roll out of the van, it would be like Cheech and Chong.
Sure. Big cloud of smoke, beer cans. And were you, you know, the good thing about being a, you know, it's good to pick a profession where you're supposed to be drunk and womanize and smoke and chew tobacco and get into fights. Because no one, it's like, it really is the white man's equivalent to being a rap star. You know what I mean? So he smoked some pot and shot somebody. Big deal. That's what he does.
Used to do. That was back in the old days.
Right, but I just mean you're going on the road. It's like, hey, did you hear Tim McGraw got loaded and banged some guy's wife? Yeah.
Sure he did.
Sure he did. Of course. He's trying to move records.
Not anymore.
But when you're traveling like that in a van, how do you get the gals? Do you bring them back to the van and then you hang a kerchief on the...
Right.
On the car door.
How's it work?
You know what? When you didn't have hit records back then, there wasn't a whole lot of getting gals.
Oh, really?
Yeah, they're attracted. I think they're attracted to hit records more than they are singers.
I thought it was just the cowboy
hat.
Well,
it's really how it works is when the Playboy air freshener that's hanging from the rear view is facing Mecca, that means you're in there with a few ladies. Now, a lot of the country boys can't figure out what direction Mecca is.
That's what we missed out on, yeah.
So now, were you, I don't know the full story of you and Faith Hill. I knew you individually, yet from afar. But had you been a big fan of hers? I guess you toured with her, right?
Right. In 96, we did a tour together. It was my first headlining tour.
Mm-hmm.
And she was opening for me. And she had a couple of hits out, and I'd had a couple of hits out.
And you were hot for her immediately?
Oh, who wouldn't be? I mean, my goodness.
Good point. And you then started up. How long have you guys been together?
It'll be 10 years in October.
Okay, so you started up on that tour.
Yeah, we started being together. At the end of that tour, we were married, yes.
Yeah, see, that's smart. You know, come from a position of power. You're headlining the tour. She's the opening act.
Totally abused my power, yeah.
Yeah.
You're gonna have to be careful, though, with Faith, though. You're going to keep her... forcibly to keep her away from Hank Williams Jr., yes? What's the story with criminal behavior?
Hank's going to be on tomorrow night on the NBC special if he makes bail.
He is, yeah.
Yeah, what happened?
I don't know what happened. He was arrested.
He got arrested. I guess he was accused of choking a waitress in a bar. He hit on her, or he tried to kiss her.
Well, means no mail. In my book. I'm sorry, but when I order a sandwich dry, I order it dry.
Now, you and Hank, though, have a kinship. You both did some Monday Night Football singing. Are you going to be doing that song anymore? The I Like It, I Love It halftime song?
I don't know. I don't know if they're going to ask me to do that again or not. I don't know. haven't heard anything about it.
That had to be a humongous pain in the ass by about week four, writing new lyrics every week to that song.
No, it wasn't that bad. You know, they wrote most of the lyrics.
Oh, they did.
Which was the bad part, but...
Yeah. Well, that's the bad part of life. I mean, I'm sure you know, Tim, you have two choices, which is do the lyrics they send you and have it be a lukewarm song, or write the lyrics yourself and spend your life writing lyrics for a halftime thing, right?
Well, you know, it wasn't that bad. You know, if it didn't work, if the lyrics didn't quite work, we'd change them a little bit. But it wasn't that bad. It only took about, you know, 20, 30 minutes every Monday morning to go in and do it.
Is it a good gig money-wise, or do you do it for the prestige?
No, I'd do it because I love football. Certainly, I don't think it was a prestige or money thing for me. It was just being, you know, I love being associated with football, you know.
Yeah.
You hear that accent, Adam?
Yes.
That Tim's using there?
Yeah.
You know, a lot of women turned on by the English accent, the mm-hmm. whole Hugh Grant thing.
Mm-hmm.
I dig the Southern thing.
Do you?
Mm-hmm. Like the Southern thing?
I like it.
Tim, where did you grow up?
I grew up in Louisiana.
And your dad, Tug, pitched for the Phillies, right?
Right.
I mean, moved
right.
around a little yes. bit. Right. But you were in Louisiana. You guys were estranged when you were younger?
Yeah, I didn't really know my dad. I met him once or twice when I was 11, I think, and then never saw him again until I was about 19.
I'll tell you the sad irony of life. The guys that don't know their dads are the dads that's like, yeah, my dad was a professional running back for the Dallas Cowboys for 9 years. I never knew him. My dad taught substitute school, and I knew him. You know what I mean? All the guys whose dads have crappy jobs, oh, they know him well. What's your dad? I know him. I couldn't avoid him. He never left the goddamn sofa. My dad was an astronaut and a pirate. I never knew him.
Never
he punched out over Korea in a F-14 many years ago. I never met the man. Yes. All the guys that do cool things for a living, you never get to know them. The guys who do the boring crap like our dads, you shouldn't know them quite as well. Yeah, that blows. But you, so your dad, now you are how old when your dad, or is your dad still pitching when you're a young man?
Yeah, the first time I met him, I saw him pitch in the Astrodome.
Wow.
And he gave up a grand slam.
Wow.
So I met him, yeah.
Still doing better than the substitute school teaching, by the way. And you're how old? So he has you when he's how old?
God, I don't know. I guess my mom was 18.
Wow, and he's in his,
I was born.
He's in his early 20s at
early
some point.
20s, yeah. He was playing for the Jacksonville Suns minor league ball when my mom met him, and they had like a summer fling kind of
hug. Wow. So it was one of those things where it was never, they were never married.
No.
And you just found out. Somebody broke the news to you at some point.
No, I found my birth certificate.
Oh.
And you did the you did the McGraw math?
Yeah.
So it's a horrible
figured
book.
It out. Yeah.
Yeah. Read it when I was in the fifth grade. The McGraw math. So, see, that's got to be great because, you know, 99.9% of the time you find out the guy's in the joint, he's doing consecutive life terms, or he's in some flop house, or he's sleeping on some box spring. This guy's in the show.
Yeah, it didn't really do me a whole lot of good, but
I know, but still kind of exciting.
Yeah, it was cool. I mean, first time I'd ever left my home terrace, pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
But was he aware that his son was Tim McGraw?
Well, Tim McGraw wasn't Tim McGraw
back then,
right?
No.
Oh, you weren't. It wasn't. Okay. Well, you were.
And were you even a McGraw?
11.
Were you?
No, I used my stepdad's name.
Cause
I thought that my stepdad was my real name.
Right. Now, is your stepdad PO'd right now?
No, he actually died.
Oh, now I'm sorry. I feel like an ass. What was his name? I'll tell you which one he should have gone with.
Harsh Smith.
Yeah, McGraw, much better. Yeah, now welcome to the stage. What the F? Harsh? Harsh? Jesus Christ. This guy! The guy with the bent cowboy hat.
Why are you good at baseball,
Tim?
He was
a cowboy. Yeah, I was a ball player. Yeah, I played all kinds of ball growing up.
And it was weird. Must have been weird, like one of those things where like you were nine and your stepdad's like, hand me the salt, son, and you're like, phew. Fastball goes flying over his head. Where's he get that from? I don't know.
I didn't have that good an arm.
All right. We're running late for break. Tim, thanks for being part of the show.
You got it, man.
I want to give you a nice plug for being so candid. The new NBC special, Tim McGraw Reflected, on tomorrow night at 8 o'clock. We'll see if Hank can be paroled fast enough to be part of the show. Hank Williams, junior part of the show. Faith Hill on the show as well. Again, NBC special Fox. Tomorrow night. No, it's not on Fox. Oh. 8 o'clock tomorrow night. We'll take a break. We'll be right back. That's little Lisa Tucker. She got last night. Mendeza got tossed. Probably took. You were lucky she went peacefully. So, could you imagine
nobody,
if she didn't want to go?
Nobody literally tossed her.
Yeah. No, if she didn't want to go, she'd still be on stage right now fighting, holding them off at bay. Oh boy, we all come in different shapes and sizes. Lisa.
Yes.
Lisa Tucker, you got voted off the week before. How you doing, my dear?
I'm doing great. How are you?
I'm doing fine, thanks. You're 16, good. Only 16.
Yeah.
You know, I have to say to my wife when we watch the show every Tuesday and then again Wednesday when people are actually being voted off, when it's like, oh, her dreams are being dashed. She's going to pick up the pieces.
Oh, no.
She'll move on. You know, no, it's sad the way people talk about 16, 17-year-old people. Everybody, please remember, even though it's disappointing that Lisa got voted off of American Idol, what were you doing when you were in the 11th grade? My dream was to get a corn dog at the Snack Shack. I never realized that dream. Do you know what I mean? When I was 16, I would walk to the Supercuts on Laurel Canyon and just dream of getting a haircut and making it to the 12th grade one day. Forget about the, you know, record deals and national stardom. You're a Valley girl, right? You're out in the San Fernando Valley?
I'm actually out in Orange County or in Anaheim.
Oh, you're in the Orange County area.
Yeah.
And you've been out here for how long? Did you guys relocate or something?
Well, we all go out to L.A. when the show starts and everything. So I've been out there for like 2 months.
But you hail from this area or were you originally from somewhere else?
No, I'm from Orange County. Originally from Orange County.
All right. Oh, I see here it's your first audition was in Denver.
Yep.
I guess. And that's what confused me. Why go all the way out to Denver?
Well, since I just turned 16, I had just made the cut, you know, because I couldn't audition any other years. And Denver was the first place that I could go to. So.
And what are your plans now? I mean, and by the way, you're in school and everything, right?
Yeah, I had to go back to school. I have to finish my senior year of high school. And then we go on the tour during the summer. And then it's pretty much, we've gotten some offers from some people. Mm-hmm. And
How differently are you being treated at school?
Well, yesterday was my first day.
Wow.
And like at lunch
nice.
And everything, they had flowers. And they were,
oh, sure. Like, MacArthur returning to the Philippines. 16-year-olds love those references, by the way. But must have been huge. But
It was funny.
Now you said the tour. You mean the American Idol tour?
Yep.
And how do they figure out who's going to be on that tour?
It's the top 10.
The top 10 will make it on the tour. And I'm guessing if for some reason somebody on the top 10 can't make it, they'll go to an alternate who got voted off number 11?
It's just Bo Bice. Bo Bice fills in.
Bo fills in no matter what.
Bo Bice.
He's a utility singer.
Yeah.
All right. So that tour starts over the summer?
Yeah, in June.
And is it the kind of thing, and again, you're just 16 years old, is it the kind of thing you're looking forward to, going out and traveling, seeing the States?
I haven't been, like, anywhere, so I'm excited.
It's weird. I don't want to sound like Pops Carolla, but it really seems like 16, when I was your age, I was wearing a wind-up beanie and playing with chewing gum and going, I don't know. Everyone is just so mature. Everyone has logged 1,000 hours of stage time. Everyone's so composed. I mean, I would have got up on stage at 16 in front of 30 million people and just plotzed.
I've done this for a long time.
A long time? But how long? You're 16.
Since I was 8.
She was in The Lion King.
Wow. I mean, it's crazy since you were 8. All right. Well, the point is, the good things, you got two good things. You have three good things going for you. You're young. You have great pipes, great voice, and you're beautiful. So you should go a million miles in this business.
Are they throwing a lot of loot at you for this?
Yeah, a little bit. Go out and do some shopping.
Ooh, wow. And okay. It is interesting. Now, here's an interesting thing, and maybe you know and maybe you don't know, but does everyone get paid the same on the American Idol tour? And if so,
I think that it starts, like, once you hit the top 12, I think you get paid a certain amount, and then when you hit the top 10, and then I think from the 10 on, I think it's just the top two that get, you know, treated a little differently.
Right. And the American Idol tour, does the American Idol headline that tour, or do they need to go on that tour?
They need to.
They do. So contractually, if you're going to be an American Idol, you whether you come in 10th place or whether you come in first place, during the summer, you will headline American Idol tour.
Yes.
Otherwise, you'll be in breach of contract. Right?
And I don't know what happened.
and are there any, well, because somebody like yourself will have a few months off and be excited to go out on tour. Maybe the person that wins arguably might want to go right into the record studio or something like that.
Nope.
They have to go, yes.
I just like the thought that, like, Taylor Hicks and Chris Daughtry, like, the guys in their late 20s are going to be touring with the 16 and 17-year-olds.
Hey, sweetie, you need a cold one? Crack one for daddy, as long as you're up. Yeah.
Tell the truth. That Taylor, behind the scenes, he
real creep,
puts,
right?
He puts his paws on you a little bit.
No. He's like a big brother.
Ace Young, like, though. He's the scumbag, right?
He's dreamy, though, right?
No.
He's all over every girl there, right?
Sweetie, my mini bar's tapped. Mind if I come into your room for a while?
You can wear my knit cap if you want.
Ace picks up on you in his falsetto, though.
Hey, take your room off. So, yes, he's so dreamy. Now, Ace, the thing that's promising about guys like Ace is you do see that thing so often with the beautiful women. Well, look at her. She's a perky blonde. She's marginally talented, but she's being carried along on her looks. Ace is sort of the male version of that. He may be nice. He may have a nice voice, but he doesn't have the pipes that a lot of the other guys have. But he is so beautiful. Even me.
He's so talented.
As a male. Well,
he's the least talented.
She's not going to tell us who's the least talented besides Dave Damashek. Oh, who do you think's going to win? Here's a quick question before we take a break, Lisa. Who do you think is going to win, and who would you like to win?
Well, I honestly don't know who's going to win. It's like, it could be a toss-up, you know, and I was watching the show yesterday, and I couldn't believe Mandisa was off. You know, I was like, oh my goodness. And I promised myself I wasn't going to pick up the phone. You know, since I'm home now, I'm going to watch the show, but I'm not going to pick up my phone because I wouldn't know who to vote for.
Yeah.
I want everybody to do so well.
Well, I liked Mandisa, too, and she got off to such a rocky start, and Simon made her, you know, he made his big jokes about her and all that stuff. I would say right now, would you say that maybe Chris and Kelly Pickler is just sort of sweet, and she's going to get the teeny bopper vote and all that stuff.
I'm sorry.
I just love that. Kelly, that song was dreadful.
I'm sorry.
You did not move at all on stage.
I know. I'm sorry.
You looked like you were drunk and had... I slid into the wrong accent. And had both legs in a cast.
Oh, Simon, I didn't mean to. I'm sorry.
Off with your head.
I'll do better. I'm sorry.
Off with your head, young lady. I know. I just loved her. She would just be apologizing. I love that. But like we were saying, it's about getting votes. Mm-hmm. And if you're sitting up there and you got your arms crossed and the guy's saying it wasn't your best effort and you go, I'd like to see you come up here and try. America's going to go, screw this pompous ass.
Yeah, but if you're go across very well.
But when she's apologizing, you're like, sweetie, it's okay. No, I'm going to call in a vote.
Lisa, did you see Paris sobbing for you? She was sobbing.
I did. Yeah. I did. You know, it was so hard because we were roommates and we had school together.
Aww.
And so we were close, you know. So.
I think that's sweet.
But we have a tour, so I told her it's okay.
And what you say you had school together, you had to have a tutor, right? Is that how it worked?
Yep. It was like straight from school to hair and makeup onto stage, you know, and like you have to stand in front of millions of people.
It is funny. You and Paris are in one room with your tutor and there's Taylor and Chris in the next room watching Spectravision getting loaded.
Oh, my God. No.
You know what I mean? I mean, because they're 35. It's crazy. All right, Lisa, we're big fans. And,
thank you so much.
Yeah, I'll say you fish tank.
Yes, you're a local girl who's made good. We'd like you to come in studio. Keep us updated. Tell us what's going on. Do a little
Definitely.
Singing for us. We'd love to see you. And also, much luck on the American Idol tour.
Thank you.
Thanks, sweetie P. Lisa Tucker, everybody.
Yay.
Nice girl.
Yes.
Very.
All right. We will take ourselves a little break. We have news with Lisa Arch. Not to be confused with Lisa Tucker or Lisa Cushell. Heading up the news. Also, Dave with the sports. Surprise guest, which I'm nervous about. Joel McHale from Talk Soup. And Mimi Rogers, all still coming up on the show.
It's the Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam Carolla now. 866-901-ADAM.
Mm-hmm. 866-901-ADAMS, the phone number. We got ourselves some news and some sports and a surprise guest, which Jimmy Kimmel booked, which makes me very nervous. Joel McHale from Talk Soup, very funny show. Actress Mimi Rogers, dear, dear friend. All right, she's coming up too. But first, it is time for Lisa Arch and the news.
Yesterday, prosecutors in the Zacharias Moussaoui case got the judge's approval to play voice recordings from the cockpit of that flight which crashed in the Pennsylvania field on September 11th, 2001, United Flight 93.
Yeah.
Most people will remember the most famous quote, which was heard over a cell phone from that flight.
No let's fat roll. Chicks. Oh, no, yeah, so no, let's no. roll. That was the second one. I was thinking of the bumper sticker on the plane. Let's roll.
Right.
I like that, yeah. Moussaoui really, his case was going okay because they were arguing that he was insane and that he was a sort of buffoon and way down on the Al-Qaeda ladder. And then he decided to do a little speaking on his own behalf, and he started talking about piloting a fifth plane that was going to fly into the White House. And he really did a lot of damage to his case, certainly in the eyes of Americans, by saying the kind of things that would just outrage any American, even if you were didn't consider yourself patriotic. We have some more tape from that, by the way, that I just want to jump in with. Not only was he talking about flying the plane in the White House, but he just kept going, and he was infuriating the jury. Let's hear that.
I wish to go to your Yankee Stadium and run across the field naked with a giant erection.
We'll be the judge of giants.
I'm going to force Whitney Houston to sing the national anthem. Not the old Whitney, the new cracked out Whitney.
Oh, that'd be a disaster.
I will steal a bucket of water from the reflecting pool of the Lincoln Memorial and the panties of Kelly Clarkson and make a soup and then feed it to your homeless.
Oh, my God. Wait. Hasn't this guy said enough?
He must have watched, Lee, you got to say this, he must have watched a lot of Entertainment Tonight or something. He's very hip on
he's very
what,
up.
What's going
he's
on
very
in
up
the world.
On what's going on, yeah. In 22 minutes, the Kelly Ripa panty soup story is going to break. P.O.B. is going to break that. Well, that's it, right? He said more?
Mm-hmm.
Wow,
oh, no.
He keeps going, this guy.
I was going to kidnap Senator John McCain, lock him in a bamboo cage and shout, diddy mao, until he cried and peed himself. I was going to illegally download copies of the new Neil Diamond album.
Oh, he says it with bravado.
So I drive to Branson, Missouri, and force Yakov Smirnoff to publicly perform oral on Andy Williams at the Grand Ole Opry.
Oh, now that's enough. I'll tell you, if this guy hasn't offended America enough, going down to Branson and perform, you know, I mean, this Andy Williams is a national treasure. Perform oral on Yakov.
It's like he wants to be put.
Yeah, it's really sort of like he's begging to be walked down to the chair. Is that it? I hope that's it. There's more?
There can't be more.
There can't be more.
Go to the Smithsonian and steal the original Wright Brothers plane and fly it into the tomb of the unknown soldier.
That's disrespectful.
That is.
Dig up the remains of Francis Scott Key, grind up his bones, and snort the dust with Courtney Love. I will go to Disneyland. Shave the country bears from the country bear jamboree and then glue sex toys to their genital area.
Okay. I've now officially heard enough.
I'm outraged.
I don't care if this guy didn't do anything before he made these proclamations. I'd like to put him down now. I don't care if we just plucked him off the street.
He's sick in the head is
sick.
What he is.
And thank God we got hold of him before he executed these plans.
Yes.
Imagine being at Disneyland with, with your Christian little brother, you know, seeing this. When a guy playing a jug, clean shaven with a strap on.
God forbid.
God forbid. All right, I'm sorry we had to digress. There's no more? There's more?
There can't possibly be more,
There can't
more,
be
Adam.
More.
I was planning to kidnap the elephants from the Ringling Brothers Circus, make them have sex into buckets, and then pour the buckets into Old Faithful, and then wait.
Oh. Oh. All right, that's enough.
No, clever.
That's okay.
He is clever.
It is. I'd say you give him an A for creativity, right. but he's diabolical.
Yeah, he's using his powers of cleverness for evil.
Makes you wonder what else they have in store for us, the ones that haven't been apprehended. Mm. God knows.
Terrifying.
All right, Lisa, I'm sorry. Continue.
That's all right, Adam. In entertainment news, on American Idol, as we've already discussed, after Kenny Rogers sang his new song, I Can't Unlove You, Mandisa became the latest to leave the show. And, you know, America was shocked. Mm-hmm. But they shouldn't be shocked. They're the ones voting.
Yes, good point.
Yeah.
How can they be shocked?
I don't know. I was shocked that Bucky, once again, was not in the bottom three.
Yes, Bucky. Well, first off, he should have been tossed just for having three earrings in one ear as a straight dude.
That's what you're going to pick on with Bucky, the earrings?
Well, first off, he's a non-talent. But secondly, and to me, when you sing country, it's just what, you know what singing country is as a singer? It's a cop-out. It's like when you do spoken word. Oh, you're not funny. I see. You wanted to be a stand-up, but it turns out you're not funny, so you do spoken word. It's a cop-out. Henry Rollins, if you're listening, please don't come down here and kick my ass.
He will,
but you know what I'm saying? It's a cop-out. If you sing country as a singer, oh, you want to be a singer. Oh, you can't sing. Oh, I guess you got to do country. If you can sing like Whitney Houston, you don't go country. And by the way, according to Massawi, the old Whitney Houston, not the new right. one. Not the new one.
I'm going to have to disagree with you, Adam.
You
I
disagree?
Think there are some pretty amazing
Oh, Tim McGraw.
Tim McGraw.
Okay.
To name one.
No, but you know
but
what I mean?
Dolly Parton, yeah. Kenny Rogers, once again, last night proving
yeah.
he's still got it.
Well, what I'm saying is if you have more attitude than pipes, I guess.
Right.
If you've
well,
got
what
a lot
is-
of attitude, you go country. He has neither attitude nor pipes.
No. And the whole point of a country song is you're supposed to tell a story.
Yes.
His gibberish style of singing, you're not hearing that story.
He told the story of him sucking.
Yes. Can we listen to Mandisa saying goodbye and thanking Jesus?
I would like to, yes.
I want to thank my fans so much. Your support has meant the world to me, and the prayers that have been lifted up for me, I know will continue to have full force for me. So I thank you, and I bless you in the name of Jesus.
Is there a black atheist?
I don't think so. Don't answer.
Just think about it. Just think about it. Have you ever met or found one? Is there one that's ever taken a stage and just said, well, I'm an atheist. Let the chips fall where they may.
I think a tuchus might be.
An atheist?
Yes.
Yeah.
I wouldn't believe in God if I were that thing.
Well,
aww.
As we learned from the trainer on the Biggest Loser, she just needs to spend a little more time with the treadmill. Work that thing right off. Flat ass and no sec.
Jesus
no time
will run
at all.
With her.
Sure.
Have you seen his abs?
He's rock hard.
And in news, we found out yesterday that Katie Couric, of course, is moving to CBS, and she's going to become the first woman to anchor a network weekday evening newscast alone. Mm. However, according to Eyebrows, Andy Rooney, not everyone at CBS is ecstatic about it. Let's listen.
I'm not enthusiastic about it. I think everybody likes Katie Couric. I mean, how can you not like Katie Couric? But I don't know anybody at CBS News who is pleased that she's coming there.
The beautiful thing about being old is you adopt the attitude that I had in the sixth grade somewhere around the month of May when I knew I was getting out of here and going to junior high no matter what. Everyone could kiss my ass. I could remember, you know, walking down the halls and having, you know, hall monitors. Do you have a pass? No, I don't. What are you going to do? I'm out of here. That's the whole thing. When you're 87 years old and you know you may be leaving this weekend,
right.
Why not speak your mind? Go ahead. This is why these guys wear jumpsuits and have dandruff all over them and wear slippers to the supermarket. Screw it.
I've thought, listen, Jimmy Kimmel says this and Mo Damashek says this. They're on the same page on this. When you're near checking out time on this big blue marble, here's what you do. heroin addiction.
Start slamming drugs.
That's yes. Absolutely right.
Jimmy in his 20s was explaining to me that one day he'll be chasing the dragon.
That's the way to do it, of
using a stroke cane to chase the dragon.
Sure.
Yeah. Yeah. That'd be awesome, though, Dave. Wouldn't that be nice, you getting just blasted out of your mind on heroin or maybe mushrooms and then staring in the mirror at your 81-year-old face thinking, what happened?
I'm melting.
looking at a picture of you from Little League football when you were 8 or 9 and then looking at yourself.
Just singing at myself in the mirror when yes. I was 17.
In my head, I'm 19.
That's right, but my teeth are 100. All right,
that's it. I'm Lisa Arch, and those were some stories.
Nice.
It's time for Dave Damashek's number one sports. Number one sports. Do it, Dave.
Here's some results from last night's the games that were played, our national pastime. The Dodgers lost to the Braves in picturesque Chavez Ravine. Mm. The Giants beat the Padres in the horribly named but still attractive Petco Park. Really, yeah. Terrible. Could you do worse than Petco Park?
I would argue that Chavez Ravine, which sounds like a euphemism for a Latin lady's vagina, is a bad name as well.
True.
Well, did you hit me a Chavez Ravine last night? You guys went into town, right, dudes? Getting a Chavez Ravine?
That's what I call my indecis.
Stop.
Beautiful woman. How dare you?
Right.
She's just as God created her.
The Snakes of Arizona won in that lovely launch pad in Colorado. This is what I was thinking. There might be better divisions in baseball, but the loveliest ballparks in the National League West. Yes, I encourage everyone to get out to the yard, including you, Ace. I know you're down on baseball because of the games, but what's more fun than going out on a sunny day to the ball yard, eating dogs and such?
It's good. You know what it is? It's an excuse for you to get your buddies together and go out and do something. But I would argue, as long as you're going to rally the troops and go eat and hoist some beers and stuff, why not do it in front of a sport that was actually interesting? That's all
baseball.
I'm saying.
Yeah. Oh, you.
All 500 games.
Philly shortstop Jimmy Rollins kept his hit streak alive last night. 38 straight now. He's chasing Pete Rose, our new pal, Pete Rose.
Dear friend, Pete Rose.
If Jimmy Rollins gets to 40, it's going to get very interesting. American League. Angels lost in Seattle against their old teammate Jared Washburn, and the Athletics beat the Yankees in Oakland. Underrated name, Athletics.
Yeah, says it all.
It's right. It's right on the nose, isn't it?
Yeah.
I was thinking you could go, I was thinking what the alternatives, you could go the aerobics.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody, a new team. Instead of these new crappy names, like you have the Minnesota Wild hockey team.
Yes,
or the Lightning. And these, you have to end your name in S.
Yes.
Is the thing, unless you're the Sox, and then you can do the X. But these things, you cannot name your team the Lightning. How about this? The Portland Able-Bodied.
Ooh.
That doesn't end in S, but it's better. It's again
how
on
about
the
like the Portland We're Gonna Winners?
Yes.
Or just Portland Base Runners.
Yeah. Break it down.
Yeah.
Talk fundamentals.
Yeah. Let's make some improvements here. Now, Dwight Gooden in the clink for at least
Shocker.
7 months or so.
Shocking.
I think our pal Sal brought this theory up before. Not theory, but he mentioned this before. Who would have guessed in the late 80s that you would have Dwight Gooden and Daryl Strawberry, these burgeoning superstars, the best in the game. Neither one, forget the Hall of Fame. Neither one of them's going to the Hall of Fame. Now they're both in the clink, in and out of the joint. It's pathetic.
Wow, the brothers can't catch a break.
Let's get some hookers and some coke and go crazy.
That was Daryl Strawberry right there talking about.
Sound like so. Dr. Phil. Interesting.
Either way, NBA, tough day for the Suns. Clippers whipped them in Phoenix. How about those Clippers? And on top of that, the Suns found out their dynamite young forward, Amari Stoudemire, is officially out for the year because of his bum knee. Sacramento, California, Kings, they won. They stay 2 games up on the Hornets in the race for the last playoff spot. Masters starts today. And, Tiger Woods, of course, the big favorite. The green jacket.
Yeah.
I can't decide with the green jacket. Would it be something I would never take off? Would I wear it everywhere I go once I got it? Or is it the worst award you can possibly get?
Well,
that you put it in the back of your closet. A nice trophy. The Stanley Cup is the greatest award. The cup, take it to a bar,
the
you
green
drink
jacket,
out of it.
Yeah. I would argue that the green jacket is dangerous. You know what I mean? You're in a field of green. Let me just give you a little scenario. You win. You win the Masters. You throw the green jacket on. Now it's time to head to the clubhouse to tilt a few, sign some autographs, do an interview. Now it's just dusk now. The sun's just moving down. You're walking out. You walk a long walk across the 18th fairway to get to the parking lot. And here comes a guy in one of those riding mowers. Okay. Now, the sun is just so where it's in his eye and he can't see you in the distance. You with the green jacket are blending in beautifully with the sod right over the top of you. Career's ended. That's it. That's the last we saw you. You know what I mean?
It's like, make a good point.
It's like a pedestrian wearing a black jumpsuit.
Yeah.
Dangerous. Dangerous.
Wow. Some victory winning the Masters. Was it worth it now?
It's like
getting shredded up.
It's that's like right. giving an asphalt colored jacket to a race car driver.
That's right.
Yeah.
It's exact. No, it's not even like. It is.
It is.
It is. So spot on, Lisa. The more you know. Yes, we should change them to Caltrans orange so they can be seen. Who wants to blend in with the turf? You know what I'm saying?
Yes, it's a hideous. It's not even an attractive green. Yeah, listen, a nice tiger, moss green.
And also, it's like you don't. If you're a weatherman and you're standing in front of a blue background, you don't wear a blue blazer. You know, Tiger Woods is standing there. It just looks like a disembodied black head. What's he doing? His head is floating above his slacks. So true.
Here's another thing, by the way, that I think this, I mean, this is an indication that that I'm gay. I've always said, you know, I love shoes and I love uniforms and stuff. And in spite of those things, I, you know, my aversion to Wang makes it so that I'm not gay. But there are indications that I might be. The
sure.
Like on Sunday, watching the Masters, every year this happens to me. The guys that are in contention, I'm always thinking, I look at them playing, I think like, well, if he wins, his outfit's not going to match the green jacket at all.
Oh, yes. That is super gay.
One year, Bernhard Langer had on all bright red shirt and pants. I was thinking, did you think at all about this before you showed up? This is your Sunday outfit? If you win, you're going to look awful.
I would argue anyone under 40 who watches the Masters is gay. But if you're going to pick apart their outfits, Mr. Blackwell, I would now say it makes you super gay.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Shackwell says, wear some nice khaki pants and a white shirt. Don't go dynamite with
it. Maybe head of the gays.
Because I just went gay all of a sudden.
All right.
11 a.m. here on the West Coast. The entire 2006 NFL schedule will be released.
Oh.
This reminds me.
You're straight again, by the way.
Thank you. Reminds me that Hank Williams Jr., the guy who sings the Monday Night Football song for so many years, has been accused, as we talked earlier, of choking a waitress. And he tried to kiss her, I guess, and she said no, and he put her in a chokehold. And I guess he turned himself into Memphis police, and we've got a bit of the confession here.
I see
he's
across
gotta sing
the bar
everything.
This cocktail waitress floozy. I try to make her kiss me cause I'm feeling boozy. Now I'm getting sued, I didn't do what's right. I put a cocktail waitress in a chokehold that night. Are you ready for a chokehold? Hank Williams chokehold. When I get the whiskey in me, things really do get started. I'm gonna have to get a lawyer who will go to court and fight. Cause I got kinda rowdy and choked a waitress that night.
Always a performer.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
That's good. Hey, by the way, everybody always says, the news girl always said, what was your closing line? That was...
I said, I'm Lisa Arch, and those were some stories.
Those were some stories. I don't have one of those. I got to have one. How about this? Let's try this out right now and then Lynch, just go straight into my my music here after this. Ready?
Mm-hmm.
I'm Dave Damashek. Game over.
Dave Damashek's number one sports.
Good stuff. Ray?
It's sports.
Yeah.
This is my buddy Ray, who I've known since the fifth grade.
How you doing, Asa?
Good, Ray. You're calling in for what purpose?
Well, we're going back to about circa 85, and it's about you.
Mm-hmm.
This is like Acme Groundlings. These are the days where you had lack of Chavez Ravine.
You talking about our mystery guest who's coming up in the next break?
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
And you should be a little nervous.
I should. What do you know about this person?
Well, I don't know anything about this person particularly. I mean, I just know the story.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that you're. I know that involves your Nissan, mm-hmm. and I know it involves a bottle of wine.
I have to do the math on that one. Yeah,
I think you already sussed it up.
I'm guessing. Well, he's talking about dating back in the day. You know, I wasn't really much of a lady killer. It was tough. Tough, because I had a beat-up pickup truck with a lumber rack on it, and I was living with a bunch of roommates.
Probably didn't help that when you were talking to girls, sometimes your friend Ray, who's on the phone, would wipe poop on you.
I don't think I ever did that while I was talking.
Yes, you did.
When?
Yeah, when? No.
Didn't he walk up to you and hit you in the side of the head with a piece of poop?
No, I was talking to a girl at the time.
I thought you were talking to a girl.
No, I was running down a hall over at North Hollywood High.
This is a day of one bedroom, three roommates sharing a bed with Donnie because he was the smallest.
Well, since when does bed become futon? Or when has futon become bed? Yes, it was a futon I slept on. I slept on a futon with a guy for a year and a half.
And Dave's gay?
Share the same futon. And then later on, we moved bunk beds into the room. It was disgusting. Thank you, Ray.
In your 20s with a bunk bed.
I know.
Unheard of.
I know. Here's the thing, too. When you're going to college, you can get away with this nonsense. When you're just living, you know, that's the whole thing. You're an officially sort of a single guy. Here's a good reason to go to college. I know we're going to break Brusca, but here's the deal. From 18 as a male, from 18 to 22, 23, it's a no man's land, a vast wasteland of vagina. There is nothing. There's nothing for you when you're on the outside. If you're going to college, well, you're just sequestered with a bunch of other people that are originally from New York, and now they're living in Arizona, and they want to whip it up just a little bit. When you don't go to college and you're just 19 as a guy, you're zero. You go from big man on campus, senior in high school, to zero. I mean, you're in the male room of life. You have nothing. And if you're, like I said, if you're not going to college, you're just screwed. You have five roommates, you drive a piece of ass, and you get nothing for years and years and years because you're just at the bottom of the totem pole. And even if there's nothing wrong with you in the looks department, that's only half the factors with women. They want to know, what do you got in your wallet? What are you driving? How's your career going? And at 19.
You know what the easy answer is, though? Wait tables.
Yeah.
Seriously.
That's the way to do it?
Just everyone's having sex in the place where they keep
that's
the wine.
That's right. You're right. Get a gig at a TGI Fridays.
That's exactly what I do.
And there's a new hostess coming through town every few, and you guys are all hanging out after closing and doing a few pops.
Yep.
Yeah. Every once in a while, you have to do that sappy thing where the local high school basketball coach retires. And you all put a picture up and then
wipe,
just relax. We actually live that. Wipe a tear away, but then it's right back to getting loaded and humping.
This guy.
All right, Chuck.
I just want to say something about this. There are those banners. This guy is retiring. He's a high school coach for probably two, three decades of this high school. They have banners hanging up. They've won state championships.
Yes.
He retires. Nobody sees him off. He just packs a box and leaves. He's bummed out. His wife takes no party for him. They just take him. His wife takes him to Applebee's.
Yes. Well,
what's his crowning award for his life's work? They hang a picture of him up next to the bathroom. Applebee's. What?
The most unrealistic part of that commercial is the white janitor. You packing your stuff? Yeah.
He gets, I mean, the coach gets teary-eyed, yes. The wife gets teary-eyed. They just put him next to the girls' room.
All right. I like the one better where the high school team loses the playoff game in the rainy November, and they stay open late. And
it's, yes.
There's a funny thing that's in that commercial where they're like, hey, guys, you ready to stay open a couple hours extra? And, of course, everyone is there immediately on board. And they go, like, they show the guy behind the grill. Sure, I'll stay. They show the waiter. Sure, I'm here. Then the guy behind the bar. Okay. Behind the bar? You got a bunch of 17-year-olds coming in. What are you doing? Behind the bar? All right. We'll take ourselves a little break. My mystery guest will be coming in next. Yes, after this.
This is Republican Representative Richard Martin. Call Adam Carolla now at 1-866-901-ADAM and then ask Jesus to forgive you.
Mm-hmm. Well, still coming up, we have Joel McHale from Talk Soup. He's doing a great job on that show. Mimi Rogers, dear, sassy actress friend Mimi Rogers, formerly married to Tom Cruise. didn't get a little out of her on that. Our surprise guest is coming in. By the way, Lisa Arch is filling in for Rachel and doing a great job on the news today. Now, we have a surprise guest. Jimmy Kimmel set this guest up, yes?
Yes.
Always trouble. Because, again, he only humiliates. That's all he does. He was really put on this planet to humiliate those around him. You know, they talk about people, you know, they eulogize people. And they're like, you know what? She was put here to be a mother. She was put here to serve others. Jimmy's put here to F with people in his immediate entourage. That's why he was put on this earth. And I guess his string is going to continue because we're bringing in a guest. It's a surprise guest. I don't know who it is. Theoretically, someone from my past. Brusca gave me a very, I almost guessed when Brusca told me an hour ago, I'll give you a clue. It's somebody from your past. Not a time traveler from the future, but somebody from your past. Well, that narrows it down to about 178,000 people.
Narrows it down to everyone you've ever met. Fantastic.
Well, but he's saying, to be fair, in this lifetime. It's not in a future lifetime where I was a proud warrior.
I also knew Ray was going to give a couple more clues.
Ray did narrow it down a little bit. I know it was during a time period. I knew this person was probably in the mid-80s, and I was driving my Nissan pickup truck with the lumber rack. Well, Lisa, you remember the old days, the Ace Man and the pickup truck?
I do. And contrary to what you think, you were not unattractive at all.
Well, no, I wasn't physically unattractive.
No, I mean, even your circumstances were not unattractive. No. Because you seemed like a guy who was going somewhere
bohemian.
And was just trying to... Mm-hmm. Yeah, bohemian, exactly.
But it seems like I would have went somewhere by... The problem with me is I was a loser at 29, not at 21. You know, 21 is, okay, this stock is going to pay off in a few short months or years. But at 29... It's looking like maybe a guy who had some promise, a stock that had some promise, is not going to pay dividends.
You know what you were kind of like? You were kind of like a barefoot prophet.
Mm.
You know? You were kind of like the hippie guy that has sex with everyone. Not that you were, but sort of like that guy.
Would have been nice,
who everybody sort of looks up to and wants to be around. Sort of like a Jesus figure.
What base did the two of you go to?
I had the hots for Lisa, as did everybody in the troupe. You know, I mean, she was young, buxom, beautiful, and talented. So everyone had the hots for her. I was at the head of that list, but she had a committed boyfriend.
I did. What a dumbass I was.
What a waste. But we may have made some time had you not been committed to a relationship.
I can say pretty much yes, we would have.
Really?
Yeah.
I'll tell you, we used to have pool parties, and I had the bedroom in the back of the house, and I would just open up my curtain, and there she'd be running around in her little red bikini. And then later, I found out using my bed to actually consummate her love with her boyfriend.
You offered your bed.
Oh, I did.
Yes.
I probably just wanted to smell it after it was done.
And then she would go into the pool, and then you would go into the bathroom and be like Judge Reinhold to her Phoebe Cates in Fast Times.
Yes, she would go, she would run around the pool, then she would run into my bedroom, use my bed very quickly, then dip in the pool, and a big plume of steam would come up as her waist was submerged in the shallow end, and then I'd be like Judge in the bathroom, yes.
I take off my bathing suit top in slow motion.
Oh, look, whether you actually did it or not, I don't even know anymore. I've did it so many times for you. I can't tell anymore. Well, the point is there was much attraction, mutual attraction,
yes,
and love we had. And as you can see, a beautiful woman, mm-hmm, Dave Damashek. So what are we doing now, Brusca? We bring in the mystery guest?
No, let Ray explain to you who it is.
Really?
Yeah.
All right. Ray?
I'm here.
Thanks, Ray. Ray, I've known since the fifth grade. Ray?
Were we just listening to Ask Us Rodeo just now or no?
No.
Different? All right.
All right.
Yeah, I think you, this was another buxom lady, so we narrowed it down quite a bit. Mm. And you had, you probably took her to Lucy's Adobe on Melrose.
Mm-hmm.
And the date went fairly well. At least I think you thought it was going pretty well. You had purchased some wine that was underneath your seat.
Yeah.
In your Mazda.
Bench seat.
How'd you fit the box of wine under your seat?
No box. Just a bottle.
Yeah.
And
I see.
I think, in fact, that bottle wound up being your music on the way home. Just the rattling and clanging of it around.
All right, Ray. Don't wax poetic. Just give us clues, would you?
And then
Rod Serling over
here.
The
biggest clue is her line at the end of the date was, take me home.
Mm.
And I thought you were scorned, but she literally meant take
me
home.
I think I've narrowed it down now to a one of 600 women who I didn't get to first base with. Thank you, Ray. Should we bring her in?
Well, why don't you say who she is?
I hope it's a her. I want to verify it by seeing her, who's in a wheelchair.
Oh no!
Yes, yes, it's Anita Barone. That's right, Anita. Let me get away from the mic. She's from the War at Home, by the way. Yeah, she's a working actress. Hold on. I'll give Anita a little sugar. I'll give you a little. It's weird hugging someone in a wheelchair,
well,
but I'm going to try.
I can rise to the occasion a little bit.
Oh, so can I.
Filibust, Dave.
Two stars coming together. Met as nobodies and now reunited.
But wait a minute. Were you really genuinely surprised just now?
Yes.
Beautiful although,
Ray helped me narrow it down.
Because I was surprised. Because I didn't know, in fact, that I was surprising you.
Oh, you didn't?
No. So I was duped in this scenario as well.
Anita, yeah. Who is currently in the War at Home Sunday nights at 8:30, is also... Well, let's see. I mean, a working actress. I think you were Jeff Foxworthy's wife, were you not? Or am I making that up?
I could have been.
Yeah, that's right. When Jeff Foxworthy did his series, Anita played his wife. But here's what happened. Well, you tell me. You know, here's something that's interesting, Anita. By the way, look at you. You've held up quite nicely over the years.
Thank
yeah.
You.
Yeah, and you can see that her and Lisa aren't so far apart in the mold department.
No.
Beautiful. The mold, the mold. Same mold.
Gotcha.
I didn't mean
I
didn't mean like black mold.
Right. Do you mean like mold, not mold?
Although
moldy,
that was my poor
like,
name, black
you know.
Mold.
The foxes run free in
yes,
the studio
yes.
This morning is the point.
Right, right. So, Anita, I think, a couple things. First, I'm a little flustered, so I'll try to regain my composure. I realize when I look back on some of my dating career, and you guys probably will find this if you ever look back and talk to the people, that... There's times you think you were dumped and they think they were dumped at the same time. Or I've talked to people where it's like, hey, man, I went out with you. I wanted to go on a second date. And they're like, you wanted to go on a second. I wanted to go on a second date. And you never called me. There's a lot of that. But with Anita, I'm pretty sure I wanted to go on a second date. And Anita
now what happened?
Did not
so
want to go.
Anita, so he presented, he had a bottle of wine with him. And then what?
Well, go back to the beginning.
How did you two meet?
Well, we were set up. By a mutual friend,
mm-hmm.
who Adam was a you were comics and carpenters together.
That's right, our friend Chris Darga.
Yeah,
you know Chris Darga.
I remember Chris.
Yeah,
we had our own construction company. It was just me and Chris.
Yeah, I just
yes.
lost power.
Yes. Oh, you don't hear anything in your headphones? Rattle that around.
So I had just recently broken up with a longtime boyfriend, and mm-hmm. So my friends were taking pity on me, and they set me up. Because I don't have a dating career. I have never had a dating career. So, but I went on a date with Adam, and we had a good time, mm-hmm. you know, but I think mm-hmm. he thought I was, I may look easy, but.
Yeah. Well, you're a passionate woman. I could see that. We went to go see Anita perform a play, I believe, that was at Beverly Hills High School. When I was set up, or this is the recon.
I forgot about all that.
This is the recon. Well, you shouldn't remember this because we were just faces in a crowd.
Oh, I see. You did a little preliminary, like scouting.
Yeah, my buddy said, I'm going to set you up. And I said, well, let me kick the tires before I kick it for a test drive, you know. So they said, well, Anita's performing at Beverly Hills High. And we went over to see. Now, this is 15 years ago.
I think so.
Somewhere around there. Yeah. Anita, beautiful now. You sure. Imagine 15 years ago up on stage, a young,
invasion.
Lusty, hungry Adam Carolla in the audience.
She looks out into the audience and sees a gigantic unibrow and says,
one day.
What sits underneath that, I must have.
She said there, right then and there, I will not have sex with that man, but one day I will be on his radio show, his marginally popular radio show. And look at us. So I saw her on stage, and Anita is an amazing talent. I mean, A lot of folks, I think, maybe who maybe the uninitiated just think, well, these actors, actresses, they do these sitcoms. A lot of these people are bona fide talents who come from the stage. Anita is one of them. I was so impressed. I don't even know what the play was, but it was all about you. And I think you're wearing something tight the entire time.
Yeah, it was a French farce called the name of that play? It was Moliere.
Yes.
And right now,
I knew what that was when I was 25 and swinging a hammer.
But we did like an updated version where I was basically like Madonna in bed all the time with a bunch of guys and partying and all that.
Yeah. Nice. It's very, very hot. So, of course, when I saw Anita, I was like, oh, yeah, no, set me up, done and done. And we did. We went out a week later or something. Yeah. I picked you up in my pickup truck with my lumber rack and my bed box and my bench seat. Ladies love a bench seat in a truck. You can slide right up to them. No worried about, you know, these highfalutin bucket seats. You got to get over the console to get to them, not the bench seat.
Right.
Slide right over.
Not unlike the Madonna video where she falls for the guy in the pickup truck.
Yes.
See, well, Anita, though, what is at this point, what is Adam's appeal to you? Yours
Good
is
point.
Obvious. If you're any. Up on the stage. You're a vision. What's he got? What's he bringing to the party?
Well, you know, he's funny. You know, Chris Darga knows that I like funny guys, you know.
Not that much. Not second base-like. Peck on the cheek-like, but not like-like. She appreciates funny guys.
You got to start out funny.
You start out, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
And so... You know, that's all. He just sent me out on one day. I wasn't ready is what
you're fresh off your breakup.
That's what it was.
Now the door opens, you open your door, Anita, and this is what's looking back at you. Adam Carolla. What do you think?
I think he's cute.
She's you don't have to say it like you're apologizing.
Well, he's putting me like, what are you like, you know,
yes.
Putting me on the defensive. No, I think you're a very handsome guy.
Thank you.
You are.
Thank you. And
you don't need me to tell you that.
We yes, I do. I need all women to tell me that. So now the thing is she's living in a condo out here, which is amazing. An owner, not a renter. Going back, you know, 15 years. I'm living in a apartment in Santa Monica with an evil roommate, driving the pickup truck, and I guess Chris and I are swinging a hammer for a living. Pick her up. By the way, going on a date was a big deal back then because it cost $80, and that was a fair chunk of change.
Do I owe you? Or?
I would say not only that, but there's interest.
Ooh, wow.
I mean, things compound over the years. So I picked her up in the truck. You're probably not impressed. We drove down your hill. We went, I think we ate at an Italian place.
We did.
I think I passed it on the ride in. It's over on the Highland somewhere. Mm-hmm. And things were going all right, right?
Yes.
The date was going fine.
Did you think he was funny?
Yes, I did think he was funny.
But what happened?
Well, nothing. Exactly.
Well, then you get into the car, you leave dinner. Ace thinks this is going dynamite.
Yeah, I think it's going dynamite.
She's a beauty. I'm a man. I got a bottle of wine under my seat.
Yeah.
Yeah, and, you know, the thing about Anita, too, is she's a free spirit, I would like to say. You know, you're not a wallflower.
I'm open, but I'm not, you know, a slut, is what I think happened.
Yeah. I oftentimes get them confused. Yeah. She's talking to me. She must be a whore. Please. Yes.
Were you hoping for the full Monty there?
No. I got to say this about Anita. First off, Anita Barone, you know, she's a paisan. You know, she's
That's
Italian.
Right.
And as a matter of fact, if you describe my wife, Lynette, you'd be describing yourself almost.
She looks, you look very much like Adam's wife, Lynette.
Yeah, a lot of guys go for the dizzy blonde look, but not me. Like, you know, for me, Paris Hilton, not into that. Not into the teenage boy with the long blonde hair. To me, give me Lisa. Give me room here, guys, is what I'm saying. Give me Anita. She's right in my wheelhouse. Mm-hmm. Beautiful, solid C cup, and then some shapely, Italian. And I thought to myself, well, this is it. I mean, we could have gone. We could be together right now. No, I mean we can be together. No, I mean this could have worked, baby. Let me. You know, so for me, it was like I'm single. It's not going to get any better than this. I'm swinging a hammer, making $370 a week under the table. I'm a loser. How am I going to do better than this? She's talented. She's beautiful.
But it was going fine. We need to know exactly what happened that made it all stop.
This is what. No, it was going fine.
What happened?
What happened is I was freshly broken up with a 6-year relationship.
You were not ready.
I wasn't ready, and it was just, it seemed a little presumptuous that you would pull a bottle of wine out from under your seat and say, he said this, he goes, should I come up?
Oh, please. I did not lift my eyebrow. I said, shall I come up, m'lady? Please. Presumptuous.
No. know.
No, and, but let me say this.
But you're so funny.
You weren't ready.
I wasn't ready.
You weren't ready.
I was not ready.
But how about this for an argument? Okay. I'm not ready for you not to be ready.
No.
So we're even. Now I'm coming up. Now drink the wine, woman. Or we'll do it in the truck.
But it was a nice date. We had
it
a
was.
Nice dinner.
We had a lot of laughs. Yeah. But you now, and did you ultimately got back together with the guy, right?
Did you not? No,
you
I did not.
Oh.
She probably used that as an excuse.
I think
she probably did,
or maybe I just heard it through the grapevine. So you remained single.
Right. Mm. I went to Europe, actually, for a little while to kind of, you know, kind of just...
Yeah, I did the same thing. I went to Van Nuys for a while just to chill out, just to clear my head. I know you're in Prague, but I couldn't make it there. Oh, what we could have been.
I know.
So much. Yeah. You know, it would have been fine, too.
Listen, your life, you're happy and fulfilled.
It's okay.
Yeah.
But you keep thinking of what could have been,
Anita,
you know?
Do you ever think back now? Do you ever, when you see Adam on the TV or, you know, you hear him on the radio or anything, do you ever think?
I used to watch Love Line a lot.
Maybe. A few short.
Did I make a mistake? Does Anita ask herself in the quiet moments, did I make a mistake? Did I miss the boat?
Well, you know, timing is just a funny thing. I just, you know, when I would see your name or I'd see you, you know, I hear you on the radio or whatever, I would just remember fondly that you were a nice, funny, handsome guy.
Fondly. And, see, as a guy, now, if you were a guy, you would have been thinking, and it was the opposite.
Right.
If we had just switched roles, you'd gone on to do Love Line and whatever, and I saw your name around and I was a guy, I would have thought, I should have nailed her. You know, or him, or me, or right. I should have. You know, that would have been a thought. Would have been nice to say, oh, that would have been that'd be a feather in my cap.
Yeah.
Be one of the more memorable notches in my bedpost. So you should have done it just so you could go, yeah, I had sex with that guy.
But that's that slut quotient that I
lack.
Yeah.
But had he not been so forward on date one, would there have been a date two?
And were I in a different emotional place in my life?
That's the thing.
Mm.
But
see,
you can't factor in. So you're saying, please.
I'm saying,
there's nothing I screwed up that Uh-oh.
Well.
What could I have done?
Well, I'm just saying.
What would
have
been?
Just that in, you know, just.
Bottle of booze.
Just leave it like that. Like, it was a great date. I'll call you later. Not
that
pulling
would've
a
done
bottle
it.
Of wine out saying, should I come out? You know, just a little. Too much too soon.
I love
Jesus
that.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah. Like, come on. Did he then call you later?
Oh, hell yes. Yes, I called, right?
I think so.
Yeah, maybe a couple times. Now,
I changed my number.
All right, but Anita, let's how dare you? Let's be honest. Fresca, show her the door. Don't ask her to leave. Just physically point it out for later.
You know, I'm in a wheelchair.
Let me say this. I know you're easy pickings now. Here, let me ask you this. So, this will haunt me for the rest of my life. But we're down in my 82 black Nissan pickup truck. We're in your parking structure.
Right.
Now it's that moment where it's a moment of truth. Do you head up? Is this the end of the day? If I had said, you know, Anita, I really enjoyed the night. You were a sweet girl and gave you a peck on the cheek and said, maybe we'll do it again some other time. Mm-hmm. We would have gone out on a second date.
I imagine that we would have.
Really? Because you thought all I wanted was sex. That's why we didn't do the second date.
Well, I was starting to put it together, like, right, because you just reminded me that you saw me in that play. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I was, you know, really out there in
that play.
You should
have cut me a break for that. The girl was in a unitard flopping around with eight guys with French accents for 2 hours. Of course I was influenced.
Yeah, so I thought, oh, he saw me in that. And, you know, we go out and we laugh, we drink some wine. He just thinks I'm, you know, a Hollywood hoe.
Well, then what was the final moment as it did go? When you said, well, I'm going to, no. You're not going to come. You shall not come up.
You shan't.
Yeah.
Yes. And
that
now, then what does he say? Does he lean in?
I think there may have been a kiss.
There was a kiss.
I think there was a kiss.
There was a, you know, night. Night. Bye bye.
Well, bye bye.
Did you pat him on the shoulder? They'll get away. Pat?
I think I pushed him off me. No.
Oh, please. How dare you? Like,
no.
I'm Hank Williams Jr.
I'm kidding.
Please. I'm insulted. And by the way, I will say this. I know it's fun to rewrite history with all your little friends here, but I say we wouldn't have gone on the second date anyway, even
Why?
If I'd not pulled out the bottle of wine.
Why not? not?
Because you were just broken up with a guy after a 6-year relationship.
Well, you're asking me. Yeah, I'm saying, like, if I were in a different emotional state, if you weren't so, you know.
I'm saying, forward. Please, it'll help me sleep tonight if I don't think I was solely responsible for us not going out on a second date.
No, it's, you know.
And again, what could have been? Because then just a few short years later, well, let's see. Yeah. 5 years later, I start making a little money.
You could have been one of the great Hollywood power couples. Instead of Pitt and Jolie, we would have been hearing about Carolla and Barone.
Carolla and Barone. Yeah. And by the way, you changing your name, Anita Carolla. Wow, that's nice. Would have worked very nicely.
That is good.
All right, we need to take a break. Anita Barone, thank you very much. I was going to say you landed on your feet, except for you're in a wheelchair. I'm sorry. You twisted your ankle, your ankle?
I ruptured my Achilles tendon.
Oh.
All right.
Yeah.
Take it easy, sweetie pea. Okay. Thank you for your candor, by the way. Took a lot of guts to come on this show. You guys understand why I was into this one over here, right?
Absolutely.
And this one.
I have two
over
eyes.
Here to my
sure.
to my right. Yes. Anita Barone, The War at Home is her sitcom. We'll take ourselves a quick break. We'll be right back after this.
Hey, this is Bo Bice. You're listening to Adam Carolla. Better bring my lunch money next time.
I want to thank Anita Barone for coming in here. The War at Home. Oh, got picked up. So all new episodes start Sunday, 8:30 on Fox. Speaking of foxes, you could see what I saw in Anita, right?
Ooh la la.
Yeah.
She's a nice-looking lady. She really was. I was thinking it before you even brought it up. She sort of was a flaxen-haired version of your wife, Lynette.
Yeah. As a matter of fact, I think her hair had less flaxen in it.
Hmm.
I wanted to put a little flaxen in it after the tape. She wouldn't let me fall. I think I probably just went home and drank the bottle of wine alone, crying. Oh.
Then you made sweet love inside that bottle.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's not okay.
Put a cork back in it.
I'm not judging it.
Yeah.
He did what he did.
I made sweet love to the wine bottle. Put the cork back in, put a second hole through the cork, and made sweet love. I need a reducer. That's what we call it in the plumbing business. Need to get a little friction on. Jeez. Yeah, I had probably officially bottomed out at that point. I was, it was later than the mid-80s, as I learned from Anita after the show. It was 91. So at this point, I've been around for a while. No success. Zero success. Zero. And now this. Oh, heartbroken. And by the way, you know, there's nothing worse when you're single than when you meet somebody and you're like, oh, now this is something. She was on TV, she explained during the break. I forgot she was with Carol Burnett, Carol and Company, or whatever, but talented, beautiful, young, single.
It's wow. Terrible,
This is perfect. And had her own condo.
Awful. Yeah, nothing wrong with her. You're thinking to yourself, she's good looking. She seems relatively successful.
She's funny. She's energetic. This can be great.
This is fantastic. And then what went wrong? Oh, I know what went wrong. Me.
That's right. Dave Damischek. No, I see what you're saying. Yeah.
But I have been there, though.
Yeah. And you know what? I was about to quit the business, but I said, no, one day, Anita will pay. And I started working. And then I got into a comedy training montage. The music pumped up. It was like Flashdance.
Like a super villain who dedicates his life.
That's to right.
A single purpose. Taking
That's right.
down Batman.
Repay Anita Barone.
Right.
That's
Did you
right.
see on the way out the tears streaming?
Trail of tears.
She was so devastated.
She realizes what could have been.
Oh, yeah.
And now she's sorry. Next. Who's next on my hit list? All right. What are we doing, Dave Damischek? You have something here, do you not?
Well, yeah, we were talking yesterday about this the Sesame Street controversy. The Muppet people, they made some videos targeted for children ages 6 months to 2 years of age.
Wow.
And so a lot of educator types say this is out of line. You know, you can't educate children that age. Enough's enough. Raising our children, you know, with the TV is already happening, as I was raised, you know, longer than you were as well, you know. But 6 months, too young to be showing videos to them. And I thought, you know, since you're, you know, obviously going to be a father of twins soon, this is something for you to get. I know you like TV a lot, but I think some of these videos.
I think they crossed the line.
Well, from what I've seen of them, I mean, yeah, take a listen to these.
Okay.
Hey, kids. Kermit the Frog here. Be sure to sterilize your needles when piercing your ears, eyebrows, nipples, and that goes double for your testicles. Pun intended. Hi-yo.
seems like they're too young.
Is that appropriate for a 6-month-old? A 2-year-old?
Wait till the kid gets to top to, yeah, you know, at least kindergarten. Yeah, that seems a little young. Well, thank God they only did one of them.
Yeah. Oh.
Hey kids, Kermit the Frog here. If you're into kinky S&M sex play, don't forget to establish a safe word and have some fun with it. Mine's applesauce.
I do agree with that one because I was burned when I was 21 months old.
But the kinky stuff, you shouldn't be getting into that when you're 2.
Again, these are all important messages, but I would argue later in life.
Age inappropriate. Age, I think this is what the educators, exactly what they're talking about.
There's more?
I don't think so.
Really?
Kermit the Frog here. Contemplating suicide? Well, do yourselves a favor and remember, it's the coward's way out. And besides, you won't get into heaven.
Well, I agree with the message there, but again, maybe a little premature.
2-year-olds considering suicide? Really?
Yeah, I don't even know how you do that.
Maybe I'm naive.
Well, I don't even know how you kill yourself at 2. I think you offend your heavy-set Mexican maid and she shakes you to death.
Mm.
I think that's the way to do it.
Well, I don't think there's any more, are there?
No. Oh. A what?
Oh.
Oh.
Hi-ho, Kermit the Frog here. If you're trolling MySpace for chicks, remember, some of those girls are dudes. Trust me. Goddamn suckers. Make a jackass out of me, will you? I'll kick that motherfucker's ass.
I do agree with that one because kids are on the computer at a very young age now. All right. Well, there you have it, everybody. Again, I think it's, I think we should say that we, you know, it's not like we do a show a week. We have to crank one of these out every day. And it's not, no apologies, but I'm just saying, factor that in. You know what I'm saying? We do a show every goddamn day and it's 4 hours long.
I'm with you, sir.
We're not Bill Maher over here. We're not, you know, doing a half hour every other week for half a month and then going off with the hookers and blowing weed.
It's daily.
So just, again, hear it through that ear. Adjust your ear for that. Your comedy ear. That's all I'm saying. I'm not making excuses. By the way, when people yell they're not making excuses, is it 99% of the time they're actually making excuses, or is it over 100% that they're making excuses? I'm not saying it's the turf toe or the flu of, I know, I don't make excuses for the way I play. I dropped that ball, but they still weave in whatever it is. All right. We will take ourselves a little break. Joel McHale is coming in. He is the host of Talk Soup. I was watching the Best of Talk Soup coming up. I guess me and Kimmel are on that. I was watching that the other day and I'm just laughing out loud.
Funny show. He's a funny guy.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought whatever's working here, it's working.
But the thing that was making you laugh out loud watching the show weren't the clips of you, were they?
Yeah.
Oh, all right.
Why did I? I didn't sound like I was laughing at him, did I?
No.
I was laughing at myself, sure. Yeah, it's only when I laugh at. All right. Take a break. Joel will be in here. And then Mimi Rogers coming in after that as well. We'll be back.
You're listening to the Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam now at 866-901-ADAM.
Mm-hmm. Joel McHale in studio, host of The Soup on E! Friday nights, 10 o'clock on E! I was just watching it, not on a Friday night, not at 10 o'clock, but still laughing. So they rerun it all the time throughout the day, right?
Yeah, they repeat it like 40 times by the time the next show starts just to get their money worth out of it.
The Joel, by the way, never met a Joel that wasn't a decent guy.
Oh, interesting, yeah.
No great Joels.
No serial killer
President
Joels.
Joels
either, right?
No, but Joel is solid as Sears kind of name. Joel's not going to stab you in the back. He's not going to bang your girl. He's not going to screw you over. Joel's solid.
But a lot of people don't know that Pol Pot's first name is Joel.
Really?
Yeah.
Joel Pol Pot.
Joel Pol Pot. Wow. He had a Jewish first name.
Wow.
It's very, very disturbing.
Oh, the man slaughtered so many of his countrymen, and yet he was a Joel.
Yeah, all the intellectuals.
Did not know
horrible,
that.
Horrible.
Wow.
Yeah. Edward's my middle name, so it makes it worse.
Even, yeah, Joel Edward McHale. So white of you.
Yes.
You hail from Seattle.
Yes, which, where I listened to you when you first came on.
On Loveline many years ago.
And one of my favorite things is when you would do the Inuit voice.
What? How'd that go?
Well, you would do the Eskimo voice. I don't know if you should say
Chief. Is it Chief Thunderbear?
I think so, yes.
Yeah,
I think
hey.
That's it. Where you would translate.
Yeah. Well, actually, Drew would translate for me.
Oh.
And I would. Oh, maybe I don't even remember
yes,
what the
he would
hell
translate
happened.
What you were saying.
Yes, and I would yell at him in American Indian gibberish. And then Drew would. It was Chief Thunderbear, American Indian gynecologist. It was like some 14-year-old chick would call me like, I have a burning sensation between my legs. And I'm like, yeah, hey, wanna kick you, wanna hockey ya. And then Drew would be like, well, you should get some Metro gel. And I'd be like, yeah, hey, wanna kaya ha. And he'd be like, oh, sorry, Your Highness. Go with another cream or something. And then every once in a while, I would just go to the heavens. Oh, yeah, and then it started getting ridiculous when I would say, every once in a while, like, she'd say,
nuts.
Like, I have a yeast infection down there, and it'd be like, he'd work that stupid thing in.
I would drive off the road.
Well, the whole thing about, well, thank you, the whole thing about doing Loveline is we would do it in a sort of a comedy vacuum. And it's interesting. I know you do the soup, and you
yes.
have people laughing. The crew is
similar
laughing.
Vacuum.
That it's a vacuum, but there's a small hole in mm-hmm. the bag that lets just a little bit of oxygen in. Loveline was me and Drew, who has no sense of humor, and then it'd be producer Ann, who'd just be staring at CNN with her back turned to us. I'd see her back the whole time, and then there was engineer Anderson, who hated the show, and then that was about it. So there was never like. There was never any, oh, that was really funny. We got to do that again because you had no idea.
You were just hoping.
You're just hoping. And once in a while, someone say, hey, that bit you did on whatever was really funny. And be like, I didn't remember doing it because I was just looking at Drew's sourpuss the whole time. And Drew, as smart as he is, and you've done Loveline yeah. with him now, has no sense of humor and doesn't ever say, hey, man.
Yeah. We get, once in a while, we'll get an intern. I'll say a joke, and then an intern will look at me weird, and I'll be like, oh, we got to drop it.
Yeah, that's the way I felt about the Indian gynecologist.
I think that should be a sitcom, and it should be a series, and it should be on Fox.
Yes. So I've just come home with my attaché case and long headdress. Yahey, manehe! And I come home, and she hands me a peace pipe and slippers.
Yeah, and she would argue with you in English, and you'd be right. like, "Well, what's wrong with the roast?"
Well, wanna kick it,
Jackiana. It's my mother's recipe.
Fat cow.
Well, how did you cook it?
No, hekeya, na chekeya.
No, all right, I'm packing my yeah.
And I would go screaming to the heavens every once in a while.
Oh, yeah, the rain god will bring you your scotch.
No, ne, wa, ha, ka, cha.
Oh, sorry for offending you again.
Yeah, no, hey. That's how it would
nice.
Go, yeah. Thank you.
I'm already tuning in.
See?
Yeah.
Controversial, but it.
We get Michael Rappaport on there, it's going to be.
Pry him away from the war at home and get him on this, baby. All right.
Anyway.
Oh, someone wants to talk to I don't want to talk. Oh, I don't want to take any calls for Chief Thunderbear. That's enough about me. We're here to talk about Joel. And thank you for the ass kissing, by the way.
It is. And it's real. It's real ass kissing. It's not the regular that I do for radio people that I don't know.
As I was saying in the 6 o'clock hour, just as you were going to bed, I was saying, I was watching Talk Soup the other day, and it was on in the afternoon. And I was laughing out loud. I thought, this is really funny. And I'm not Talk Soup, but the soup. But you really done a great job with it. And I was almost surprised because when you turn on the TV and something is supposed to be funny, you barely crack a smile these days. And it was laugh out loud funny. And I thought, this guy mm-hmm. is good. And then I thought, he must be stopped.
Yes.
And that's why we've brought you here.
Yes.
That's what my little internal critic says all right. the time. Well, if we got clips of Flava Flav, we can't really go wrong.
Who is, and it seems like the on-set laughter is even greater than it was. Now, there's no audience.
There is no audience because the studio was not rated for an audience because literally it is a lobby that has been converted into a studio. No joke. There are still pylons going through the studios. And we have, and I'm not kidding, interns get credit if they come to our show at night because it's after their hours. So they get, like the USC and the Cal State Northridge people get credit if they show up. So we get about 10 interns, and then it's our staff who, and you'll notice the laughs will be a little bit louder depending upon whose joke I tell.
Right, the guy who wrote
it. So they're like, oh, written by Lee Farber.
Yeah,
and,
right.
And they will be very happy about it. And then we have Tom, who's still there, who was part of the original Tuxedo.
With the mustache?
He dropped the mustache and the mullet.
Sad.
Yeah, well, it's sad. Mm-hmm. Now he's much more clean. It's because we're now Team Seacrest, and we all have to be clean shaven and short hair.
It's like the Yankees.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly. And so we get, and then there are also family members and homeless people that wander through.
It is, there's something sort of, you know, when you hear the laugh track, you feel like in the sitcom, you feel like it's being spoon-fed to you, and you're being, it's almost
manipulated.
Intrusive. Yeah, you're thinking, that wasn't that funny. I don't like this being spoon-fed to me. But hearing the crew and the camera guys and all that sort of laughing but not over the top is somehow very, I don't know, inviting or something. It's relaxing. It's a nice way to go. We did, I think I hosted Talk Soup with my partner, Chief Thunderbear. No, my partner, Dr. Drew, and with Jimmy Kimmel.
Mm-hmm.
I got into a little spat with the folks over there about it.
You're kidding.
You heard.
You mean, did you want to tell a joke that possibly was funny and stuff?
Well, that's the problem they had. Again, this is the old regime. This is when it was Talk Soup. But what happened was is they wanted to load up the teleprompter for me and Dr. Drew. And I said, you know, the way Dr. Drew and I work is we take it and we run with it. And by the way, I'm looking at Drew half the time, sort of physically. My line is toward him and I'm saying, what do you think of this? Or you're an idiot. I'm not looking at the teleprompter.
And beyond that, you can't read.
Thirdly, thank you. I read at a third grade level, so this is going to be a disaster. Let me and Drew do what me and Drew do. And they said, we got you. But I didn't believe them. And when I was driving in, I said, look, don't load up the teleprompter because the thing about
it's
the teleprompter,
it's just going to be going by no reason.
Teleprompter is one of these things where you're either on it or you're off it, but you're never sort of halfway on it. You can't sort of read a mile of scrolling text and then find the name of the person you're making fun of in a sea of text. You know, it's like, so I said, give me the big beats. Tell us the story. Just tell us the story and then we'll riff on it and we'll go to the next story. Big italicized, and we'll go to the next one. They wouldn't do it. And then we sat down, and by golly,
there it was.
Loaded for bear.
Teleprompters are not set to take bullet points.
Right.
They can only take complete sentences.
Yes, and I was like, look, it's no offense. I'm sure all the stuff on there is marvelous. It's just I'm looking at Drew. And by the way, we don't have a job where we've ever seen a teleprompter. We sit around and just go back and forth. That's the way we do it. It'll be more comfortable for us, and you'll get a better product. Yeah. No way. And we just had to keep going and going and going. And eventually we got to the end of the day, and they said, well, you know what we should have done? Should have just cleared off the teleprompter and put it in beat form. And I talked to 28 people about this, and they're like, whoa.
That is
attitude?
I call that a classic E experience. That's exactly
Then their feelings were hurt. They were like,
of course,
what? You're talking to us like you're children. I was saying, I told you a week in advance. I told you on the goddamn ride in. Whoa. We just came up with this idea. I know. I told you to do it. Well, okay.
It's our idea, and it's a good idea, and I don't know why you're trying to take it from us.
Then it was like, well, this Carolla is a prima donna. He's out of hand. He may have been high. I felt threatened. Did you feel threatened?
Well, yes. I can barely. I've been doing it for 2 years, and I can barely read the teleprompter still because I have like half dyslexia. So I.
Well, I think you're doing a spectacular job.
Well, but you're going to be on the special. Did you know that? Yes.
Is it me and Jimmy or me and Drew?
I think it's you and Drew, and there might even also be a clip of you and Jimmy. I'm not sure. It depends on what they're swapping in out. But I know for sure I saw the Drew clip, and then so I think there also might be a Jimmy clip. So
that's great. Can you believe this, Lorena Bobbitt? And I'm sitting there with a mullet, wearing a Don Johnson circa 1987
blazer. A generic sweatshirt.
Yeah. All right, let's take a little break. Joe McHale here from The Soup, Friday nights on E! We'll take a quick break, maybe a little Ask Kiss Rodeo. Not that this
seems
wasn't.
Like a good idea, yeah.
It's getting warmed up.
Fitting.
By the way, you look great today.
Thank you. You look hot, too. Much taller than I pictured you. Actress Mimi Rogers, dear friend Mimi Rogers coming in as well. All that after this.
Finish it with my woman, cause she called help me with my mind. People think I am insane because I am bromine in time.
Yeah.
That's your chief character. That's very similar.
Oswaldo, yeah, that's where I probably picked it up.
Austin, but nothing seems too sophisticated. Thing is lose my mean. I don't mean so many things.
Imagine building a house with this guy. 16 years I worked with him.
He barbecues the mean flank steak, though.
Very true.
Mm.
Oh. Nobody makes the flap steak like Ozzy. All right.
I need some to know within a life in country things. I can see the thing, the market through happiness, and with the blind.
Get Idol on the phone.
Yeah. Nicaraguan Idol. All right, that's enough. Joel McHale here from The Soup, Friday nights, 10 o'clock on E!
Yes.
Much revamped and much improved. Soup is, it's had its ups and its downs over the years. I would definitely say it's on the rise with Joel at the helm.
And he's a funny guy. And for the funny guys who has athletic achievement in their past, like that can match Joel's.
Yeah,
bring
you,
it.
You played football at the University of Washington?
All right. I was the greatest practicer ever.
Mm-hmm.
I went practice with some of the greatest football players in University of Washington history.
But this wasn't when they were crummy either.
No, this is when they were good. I got leveled so often. It was great.
But just the idea, just to put on the pads and get out there on that AstroTurf must have been a thrill.
It was great to run out with 70,000 people screaming and just run right to the sideline.
Yeah.
And just cheer with those full pads on.
Still.
Helmet. I'd raise my helmet in the air.
Wow.
We were rallying. It was great. One time I made it into the paper because Napoleon Kaufman, who at that point was the greatest running back, was just tearing down the sideline, and I was just slightly blurred on the sideline like this.
Yeah, he knew you as Whitey 28.
Yeah.
That wasn't your number, but I just mean there were 30 white guys on the team. And
he had a numbering system.
He got free Gatorade.
Yeah, and 28 being the whitest, one being kind of mulatto.
That's what I love about football. Even I played in high school in the year at the junior college level.
Nice.
One time, there was a guy named Garrett on our team, and this guy was one of those guys who was chronologically 17, but looked like he was in his mid-40s, had done time in juvie, had been stabbed by his girlfriend. He was a brother. He was one of these brothers that had freckles and a huge fro and, like, calves, you know, and just he was built like a mountain. And there was a guy who was on our team, Dennis Donahue, who was a Duran Duran fan. It was like a sort of new wave romantic guy with the scarves and the eyeliner and everything. Yes. I don't know what the hell he was doing on the team. But the point is Garrett entered the team late because he got sprung out of the joint or something and showed up and saw Dennis Donahue in the locker room and threw him out. He didn't even know who he was. He was like, hey, man, get out of here. Get that fairy ass out of here. And it was like, Garrett, Mike. His
but
name
I'm
Mike
on the
Garrett.
Team.
He's on the team. I don't give a good get him out of here. And it was like, I realized, wow, that's what you got to did.
This is real.
Did Napoleon ever toss you out of the locker room?
There was no eye contact allowed.
Did he know who you were? Would he have known your name?
I don't think so, but I was great on skit night, so after that, I think he kind of knew who I was.
Yes.
I killed on skit. That was the most respect I'd ever gotten. And then, of course, the next day of practice, I had the wind knocked out of me 8 times. So
right.
It didn't matter, but each time they would pull me up, they'd be like, that was funny, man. And then they would just punch
still,
me in the mouth.
Exciting, wearing the jersey or on campus.
It was
great. Getting ladies getting excited. Huskies, nice jersey. And by the way, the purple and gold or purple and pewter, whatever it is.
Yeah.
Works well. And
it was great.
It's distinctly a college uniform. You know what I mean? There's nothing in the pros that really comes close to it. Maybe the Vikings, but not really.
Yeah, you know, and you wouldn't think it. Purple and gold would work, but
no,
it works really well.
But it does, and you were there during the glory years.
Oh, it's great. And then, of course, it all came crashing down with the horrible scandal.
Sure.
Of a few players.
You raping taking, the cheerleaders.
Well, they were taking loans and stealing cell phones. But other than that, they were totally on the up and up.
We were going to play a little Ass Kiss Rodeo with the Athletic Joel McHale. And let me say this, everybody, you make fun of yourself because you have a good sense of humor, but you had to be great at the high school level even to walk on to a team like that.
Well, here's the weird part. I did not play in high school.
What?
Oh, I hate these kind of guys.
I was recruited to row at the University of Washington. I was lanky.
For the crew team, or do you guys have a Viking ship?
What?
Because my college, LA Valley College, we had a Viking ship.
It was one of those.
I was confused. I was like, oh, crew, this is going to be awesome. And a bald guy in a leather tunic, sweaty, was whipping me my entire sophomore year.
That would have been
year.
So much more interesting than crew if we were to attack a village.
Lads, get the flaming arrows ready.
Yeah, Vassar did a horrible job of pillaging on that one. That would have been great. But no, I was recruited and to rue and wrote. Wow.
Dear God, what's happening?
All right, but then I did. There was so much hazing going on.
Yes.
with the crew guys.
Yeah,
they wanted if you were on the freshman boat, they wanted to shave your head and shave your eyebrows off and put all the hair into a hair pillow. No joke. And then there's a display case of all the hair pillows. So I was like, I don't think I'm going to do that. And then I was in a fraternity, and the guy said, you should try football.
Oh, really? I rented hair pillow last weekend by a horrible porn. I was going to give
it
a shot. Yeah, not good. Even if you're into that thing.
It was really popular in 78. But then I joined the football team, and there were some guys that helped me out. And I was bad, really bad at first. And then I got redshirted. So I felt vindicated on that.
That's crazy, though. You get recruited to be on the crew team, and then you don't want to shave the thing and go through the hazing. And by the way, I don't think you can haze like that in this day and age.
I wouldn't put it past them, but I hope not.
Well, there's nothing dangerous about shaving your head and your eyebrows.
I know, but it is, everyone's so litigious mm-hmm. these days, and they would say that you were scarred, and now you can't even go into a barber without breaking down and all that kind of stuff.
I should sue, though. That's great.
You should definitely do that.
Oh, all right, guys.
But you turned it into a comedy gold mine. You took all the pain and the humiliation and
all
you
the experience. Yeah, I cashed. Yeah.
You want to play a little Ass Kiss Rodeo?
Yeah.
Well, let me explain the rules of the game for those who aren't initiated. I go ahead and bring up a topic. You go ahead and agree with me. You kiss the topic's ass. You kiss my ass. And we'll give you a little clue. Damashek, let's just do a quick dry run. I know you don't play competitively anymore.
Exhibition, just
quickly.
All right.
I love ribs. I love barbecued ribs.
Ribs are dynamite. You should, somebody, the smart business owner of a rib joint should bring you over a gaggle of ribs right now so you could enjoy them and maybe endorse them. Their sales would go through the roof with Adam Carolla's name stamped
on them. So it's not only are ribs great, but how do they affect me and how do we weave me into the whole thing?
Even though that was just, I'm a veteran of the sport and I almost made one of the most common mistakes of I enjoy ribs too. No one cares what you enjoy.
Right, I see.
Not even you.
I've seen you eat ribs before and you're one of the only people that eat ribs in a non-sloppy way.
Yeah.
You're actually attractive when you're eating ribs.
Thank you, yeah. I don't need the bib. I don't need the moist
towelette. Whether it's, baby back, blue smokies from Tony Roma's. Any of those, really. You look very great
doing you.
It. This is like the guy who does a couple of laps before the event starts.
Yeah, this is essentially you shaking it loose. Yes.
Yeah. All right, my lips feel great.
All right.
I'm good.
You ready?
It's Ass Kiss Rodeo.
I love ribs. No. Did I say that one? We use that one?
Whatever you say.
I'll tell you, I love The Soup. That is a great TV show.
I agree that it is great, but not because I'm on it, but because you watch it. You know what's great is that the way your eyes look at the television, the plasma screen, the 42-inch LCD, The Soup is really only enjoyed on a 60-inch LCD made by Philips that is available right now at Costco that I would think that they would actually benefit from you having that 60-inch
I could receive a freebie,
yeah.
Yeah, though I liked it much better when Aisha Tyler was at the helm.
She's hot. I agree completely. But you know what was great is that when I talk to her, she often will bring you up. Mm-hmm. And I go, can we please stop talking about Adam for once? Mm-hmm. And then she's like, all right, just one more thing. Have you seen his abs? And I was like, why would I have seen his abs?
Uh-huh.
And he's like, I think six pack, it's more, it's a half rack. There's so many muscles showing.
Back to the ribs. I like that. Football, great sport.
Oh, man. You know what's great about it is that when you were playing, it was such an innovation because junior college is usually not associated with great football playing.
Right.
But everyone, when I was a walk-on at the University of Washington.
Oh, hold on.
It
turned to you. Mm-hmm. It turned to you.
No one cares.
I know you're bring.
Nobody cares about you, Joel.
Bound to happen.
I know we're going to bring it back to me, but when? When?
I was going to say.
They were like, now let's get out there like a Carolla.
Oh, yeah.
Let's get out there.
Again.
Because it means 110%.
Again, it was a very nice try.
A noble
Joel.
Effort. Jeff Probst. The celebrity champion holds on to the belt, but barely.
Yeah.
Also, I don't want to nitpick. Who am I to nitpick? But I will say this.
Nobody.
There was a little bit of Adam bashing when Aisha Tyler brought up Adam. Mm-hmm. I don't want to know about Adam's spot. No, you should. That you desire to see.
Right.
But you know what? Listen. I don't want to play armchair QB.
I understand.
You know?
I understand.
Hindsight 2020.
I just wanted to show the black and the black and the white version.
That's obviously not the point, though. Of
you're right.
No, you made a choice. Well,
look, let's not live in the past. It was a noble effort.
Thank you.
We shouldn't dwell on the negative. You did a lovely job.
All right.
It's not quite up to Jeff Probst's standard.
He was right there, though. I will
right
say that.
Right there. Joel McHale, we're going to take a break. I want to thank you for coming in.
Thank you for having. I'm sorry I didn't have a pink cast on.
Our pleasure.
It would have been something to talk about.
The day is young, my friend. Ease the soup, everybody. Friday nights, 10 o'clock on E! And repeated throughout the day, as I know because I watch it throughout the day. The Best Of is coming up also. It's going to have me and Drew and
yes,
Kimmel and
April
me.
9th. Yep.
April 9th. So watch that. We'll be right back.
See the
with,
mullet.
Who's coming on? Yeah, Mimi Rogers coming up, too. All that after this.
Hey, this is Jeff Probst, and you are listening to the greatest radio and television personality of all time. It's the Adam Carolla Show.
That's why he's got the Ask Kiss Rodeo celebrity belt. Mimi Rogers is going to be in here. Boy, I'll tell you what. C Cup Thursday. Plus. Lisa in here filling in for Rachel. Mimi Rogers, beautiful rack. Anita Barone. It's a hell of a rack. Boy, I'll tell you. What a rack day.
And
not your Hollywood, saline implant business either. This is just as God made them. All right, speaking of beautiful racks, it is time now for Lisa Arch and the news.
I think that's how Katie Couric is going to be announced the CBS Evening News.
I think it's her big, beautiful gums that got her on the cake.
Homeland Security press aide Brian J. Doyle, who got caught sexually preying on what he thought was a 14-year-old girl, has been suspended and stripped of his security credentials. Here's a quote from Sheriff Grady Judd about the case's biggest shocker.
What shocked us was he didn't hesitate upon the first conversation to identify himself as a deputy press secretary for Homeland Security. He emailed photographs of himself with his DHS security tag clearly visible.
I would argue, now there's a couple things. First off, I admire this kid's moxie. He's got moxie. You know what I mean? On one hand, I like a security guy who's aggressive. Well, let's face it, most guys that are in security that are in the business of security are criminals. That's just how it goes. Mm-hmm. Cops, security, even homeland stuff. But I would argue that on some deep level, the guy wanted out. I sort of believe that when people do kooky things and leave phone numbers and ID badges around, that on some deep subconscious level, they just want a break. They just sometimes it's even prison.
Yeah.
I think Mike Tyson wanted that. I think it's like, I'm tired of the limos and the chicks and the tigers and the fur coats. I want a year. I want to just sit down. I don't want everyone looking at me. I think he wanted out.
Not a bad theory.
Yes. Why else would you show a 14-year-old or what you thought was a 14-year-old your badge? Like, that has something, that's going to arouse a 14-year-old. Ooh, Homeland Security. What? Wow. All right.
I like this story. A new study from the University of North Carolina finds that only 15% of obese people think they're as fat as they actually are. Hmm. When asked their height and weight, most of those fatties are completely inaccurate with their answers.
Really?
Yeah, totally lie about it. Or they don't think they're lying. They just say, yeah, I'm 5'5 and 118 when they're really 5'4 and 340.
When we used to do Loveline, I would always ask, how tall are you? How much are you fat? And they'd go, no. They'd talk some chick and be like, well, I was thrown off the cheerleading team because they didn't like the way I looked in a skirt. And be like, well, you a big gal? No, not really. Average size? Well, how tall are you? 5'4 and a half? Uh-huh. How much you weigh? 210, 215. It's like, hello, that's big. There's a lot of people that just think, 5'3, 5'4, and 175. It's just average. I guess when you're hanging around with the new size of human beings, mm-hmm. folks that won't fit into the child seat when they were 9 months of age, the ones we're having to modify the gurneys for at the hospital, that perform surgeries for, I guess compared to them, not. But if you take a look at the body mass index thing, you're 5'3", 5'4", you're supposed to be 125 pounds.
Tops,
baby.
Bruska, 5'4", 263.
I would argue that because he's a lesbian and has a thicker, lower half, that he wears it well.
I'm chubby or I'm a lesbian.
Please.
Don't give him some credit where credit's due. He's got ample bosoms.
Well, that's true. I said
he's got to weigh 20 pounds.
I said it was C-cup Thursday. It's now been revised to D-cup Thursday. And mammoth areolas.
Mammoth. Oh, dear Lord. Mm-hmm. In Back East news, in Brooklyn on Tuesday night, a couple of Hasidic Jews jumped some cops that were arresting one of their friends. 75-year-old Hasid Arthur Schick was pulled over for talking on his cell phone while driving, which is illegal in Brooklyn. And apparently the cops got a little rough with him. His friends saw what was happening, and they attacked the cops in original gangsta Jew style.
Well, it's driving while Jewish. I mean, look, we're all thinking a Jew can't make it 10 feet down the road without the man pulling him over. It's probably worse here in L.A. Dave, you're Jew, right?
I am, but yeah.
Can you drive without being pulled over?
Listen, I good luck getting a cab.
Yeah.
If I go out by myself, I better have
you're not
ride
be able to
arranged.
Hail a cab down.
Good luck.
Yeah.
But this has to be the darkest day in police history.
Yes.
Getting whipped by some Hasidim.
Yeah.
Yeah. These guys need to be kicked off the force. Clearly cannot fend for themselves against some Jews.
The ass kicking I'm going to give you, won't even know.
They probably yelled some slurs at him first. May your head grow on the ground like an onion. And then they kicked the cop's ass.
There's probably a lot of spitting, a lot of patooey, patooey.
Yeah, I'll tell you, that is one of those times where you and your partner have to get your story straight before you head back to headquarters. Listen, I don't know if we got to take the car and just ram it into a tree. Say that's how we got the cut on the forehead. Whatever we got to do, let's just get on the same page before we head back to. We're certainly not going with Myron and Ishmael beat the crap out of us out on the street. All right.
I'm Lisa Arch, and those were some stories.
It's time for Dave Damashek's number one sports. Number one. Do it, Dave.
Hey, she has her thing. Those are some stories. Right. I want a new opening now. I want you to start saying every time you say Dave, because this is sports, I want you to say Dave, he knows the score.
Okay.
You want to try it again? Double meaning. Yeah.
Try it again? Yeah. Now, when do I jump
just
in? After the VO?
Me. No. Yeah, you just go ahead. Just as though we just heard the music.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
And now it's time for Dave. He knows the score.
Yeah, that's good because you understand the double.
It's time for Dave.
Yeah.
All right. Now, let's talk about this. In just a couple of hours, less than a couple of hours from now, here on the West Coast, the entire 2006 NFL schedule shall be announced.
Wow, huge.
Can't wait. Now, we will bide our time with some talk of our national pastime, baseball. The Dodgers lost to the Braves here in L.A. Giants beat the Padres down in San Diego. The Snakes of Arizona won in Colorado. And Jimmy Rollins in the National League, the big story there, 38-game hitting streak now. He's after Pete Rose, our dear friend Pete Rose. He's six away from tying the National League record. And, of course, 56 is DiMaggio's. American League, Angels lost in Seattle against their old teammate Jared Washburn. The Athletics beat the Yankees in Oakland. And we talked about that name, too, Athletics.
Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah, it says it all.
On the nose, Oakland winners might be the only thing that's cooler than Athletics.
Yeah. It's nice, and it's a, like, what is it, like 100 years old? I mean, it's an old team,
been
right?
around a while, yeah.
And they, well, wait a minute, they have an elephant. Isn't an elephant?
I don't get that one. I forget what the connection is.
Somebody needs to work this out. Someone needs to go to Stanford and explain the tree doesn't work very well as a mascot. You guys don't need an elephant.
Georgetown Hoyas have a bulldog. I don't know what that association is.
Hoyas a bulldog. Yeah, there's a lot of ones that just, you have to get on the same mascot team name page. Yes? Right. Athletic, have a big jock strap
line. When I take over, when I am named, finally, when the long overdue title of Czar of all uniforms and mascots, which is the ultimate goal, that will be something that will be rectified.
Well, I'll tell you what, we'll throw it in your coffin when we bury you. I mean, in that way, it'll be one of those, what he wanted.
Dwight Gooden. Yeah. In the clink for at least the next 7 months or so, he violated his probation. He did some toot. Some blow, some chotch.
Yeah. Let's get some hookers and some coke and go crazy.
This is what's the weird thing. He chose to go to prison rather than have his probation reinstated, because if he would have violated it again, he would have been put away for 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
Not much intestinal fortitude. He knows how I can't.
Well, I guess if he's hooked and he's strung out and he knows he's going to screw up, this is the way to do it. Maybe he just wanted to dry out, and it's kind of what I was saying earlier. Maybe he just wanted to stop the merry-go-round of life and get off. Mm. You guys ever feel that way?
Sometimes.
Yeah.
Not in jail, though.
Shh. Dave, we'd stop the merry-go-round, but you had to yap. You'd open your fat trap and get the merry-go-round turning again.
Try it again.
You ever just want to stop the merry-go-round of life and get off?
NBA. No?
Just, all right, you go on the merry-go-round, Lisa. Let's get off the merry-go-round.
I'm already off.
Oh, me too.
All right. It was a tough day yesterday for the Suns. The Clippers whipped them in Phoenix, and they also found out that their forward, Amari Stoudemire, is done for the year because he's got the bum knee. So their chances of going deep into the playoffs, not looking that good. Sacramento, they won, so they're two games up for the last playoff spot in the West. Round one of the Masters is underway. And there are a whole bunch of guys not named Tiger Woods tied right now, -1. Tiger's two back, I guess, right now. But the other thing we were talking about is the green jacket. I'm conflicted on, it's a very ugly award, you know.
Yes.
Give me the cup, the Stanley Cup. I'll take it to bars. I'll drink beer out of it with my chums and stuff.
Right.
Green jacket, where am I going to go with it?
Yeah.
But then again, nobody who has a green jacket unless you won the Masters. Here's my biggest thing. As I say, I preface it by saying, I realize, makes me sound gay. Yes, I love shoes.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I have a lot of shoes. You know, I have a natty interior decorating touch, but I have an aversion to Wang. Hence,
yes.
I'm not gay.
Right.
However, here's what I see when I watch the Masters on Sunday every year. I see these guys wearing these outfits as though if they're in contention. Did they consider how ugly that outfit's going to be if they win the green jacket? These guys wearing the red shirts and stuff. It's hideous.
Yeah,
Hear my words.
Golf is all it's plaid slacks and horrible shirts. I mean, golf is about ridiculous
outfits.
It's
going to be hard to match the green jacket, no doubt. I agree with you. It's ugly clothes. But listen, put a little forethought into this so you look smart. Your picture's going to be taken. For decades, you're going to see pictures. We wear a nice white shirt.
Well, at least it's not a green members only. That would have been a mistake. You know what I mean? At least it's a nice cut, sport cut.
The Blazer's more timeless. Yeah, you're right on that. You're a regular Bo Brummel.
Dave Damashek's number one sports.
Mimi Rogers coming on the show in a second. Eric?
Hey, how's it going?
Got something to say to Dave in his number one sports?
Yeah, Dave, he knows the score. Dave, you never give the score. Obviously, you don't know the score.
That's true.
Wow.
You know why? Where would I get these scores? How am I to know what the score is?
Games are over.
That's true. You make a good point.
I guess you could go on the computer. Sometimes they have stuff on there.
Have you ever heard
of
a newspaper?
Work. No.
What was that? What was the last one?
How about a newspaper?
Newspaper. It's a paper that contains the news, evidently.
Right.
All right,
and it
noted.
Has the scores in it.
Noted. Okay. Thank you for your help with helping me out with my job. And you, let me return the favor. It looks like there's a customer at pump number 4, and I'll go fill them up.
All right.
That's Dave. That's all he can do.
pump number four. Have you learned that there's no longer a gas station attendance, Dave? Nobody actually goes out there.
There are
anymore.
In Oregon.
That's right. And that's where he's calling from, Las Vegas, Oregon. All right, we will take ourselves a little break. Mimi Rogers, dear, dear, beautiful, busty. C-Cup Thursday continues with Mimi Rogers after this.
You're listening to The Adam Carolla Show. He's so hot.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of hot, it's C-Cup Thursday. We're keeping this party going with Mimi Rogers. I'll revise it to D-Cup. It's just been raining boobs. And I hope you take that in the spirit in which it's intended. But the girl to your left, Mimi.
No, she's got
Lisa's
a pretty good
beautiful rack.
Too.
And then Anita Barone earlier. Nice. And then, of course, there's Bresca.
But I have a pressing question, Adam.
Yes, yes.
What cup size do you wear?
Well, I am. I probably started off as an A cup in junior high and yes. high school. But yeah. as I've grown into my man years, I'm probably up to a B plus.
Okay, I think we're talking the wrong cup.
Oh, I see you're talking downstairs.
I want to know what cup size
you wear. Wow, that was humiliating.
Yeah.
So is his cup size.
Yeah. Wow, so embarrassed. I'm lactating. Let me, I will say this in all candor about my junk.
Yeah.
A lot of guys, there's a large chasm between what they're like flaccid and what they're like when they're aroused.
Right.
You know what I mean? I feel sorry for those guys because at the gym, no one knows how good they actually can be.
Unless there's something really weird going on.
Right, right. That's right. Now, I have what I like to call a good gym set. You know, I look good, you know, stepping out of the sauna. That's why I rarely wear a towel. I'm one of these guys who pretends to be drying his hair. Meanwhile, I'm just flexing and I've oiled up my junk. Yes, it's annoying. And people come by, look, Carolla, fine, but would you have to stand on the bench to dry your hair? Hey, I don't tell you how to dry your hair. That's how I work it. So, but when blood ultimately does flow that direction,
yeah.
occasionally, it only steps up marginally. Whereas a lot of guys can go from, you know, an acorn to a mighty
I've
oak.
I've heard that referred to as shower versus grower.
Interesting.
Right. Yeah.
We learn something new every day.
Yeah, I think I'm a shower. Plus, I'm thinking about having a scrotal reduction because everything is relative. And that's
wise.
You know what I mean? Like if you're a guy, you see these guys every once in a while, they have no waist.
You're talking about HDB syndrome?
The what is that?
Hang down.
The sack is lower than the
Sacular situation.
Yeah, depends on the weather. Depends whether is keep talking about Dr. Drew. If the cremasteric response is in full effect, which is essentially landing gear going up, which happens to your scrotum when you go into cold water. Your scrotum is smarter than you are. You go into a cold ocean, your scrotum's like, I want no part of this wise ass. I'm going upstairs. Call me when you hit the towel. Yes, yeah, that's when it does. But if you shorten that up just a little bit, I think.
Shimming also helps the the look of the
I was saying,
junk.
No, I yes, trimming.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know what it is? And it's not all going to be penis talk with Mimi Rogers, but that'll be the lion's share of it. I would say to people, if you have a mailbox on a post and it's out in the front yard and the grass around it is grown up so high that there's only a couple inches of post sticking up, well, it doesn't look like much of a post.
Just get out that lawnmower.
You go trim it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Weed whacker.
That's right. Yeah. That's how you like your men? A little grooming?
Weed whacker.
You like your men trim down there, don't you?
Oh, yeah. Nice and shiny.
Yes. Yes. You're a woman of passion, yes? Well, not
you're
shiny.
You don't want
shiny. It's weird when the guy gets out the wax. What you want is he looks like he looks kempt down
neat,
there.
Neat, yeah, neat, yeah.
That's
very nice.
That's what you want.
Good presentation.
Yeah,
absolutely.
But you don't want the porn star wax.
No, that's weird on a dude,
right?
No, that's really creepy.
Right.
Super creepy.
All right. Well, other than critiquing genitalia, what are you up to? Ah, yes, The Loop Thursday nights 8:30 on Fox
tonight, baby.
That's right.
8:30.
It's a very funny show.
It is a very funny show.
It's not done in front of an audience, is it?
No. We are a single camera filmed comedy.
Yes, which is much nicer.
Which is much nicer. It's harder work. It's harder hours. But I think the result, I think there's so many more ways to be creative when you're filming.
Yes.
You know, when you're doing a staged in front of a live audience show, there's certain limitations that, you know, just go with the territory.
In a certain way, is it just, as I think about it, it's sort of the difference between doing an animated show and doing a film show. If you're The Simpsons, you get to do all sorts of crazy things because it's animated. Right. You have the time and the space. You can pull it off. When you're doing a show in front of an audience, it's essentially like doing a play. There's just only so much
you can do.
Right.
Exactly. So on our show, you know, we can have zip lines going from the apartment to the falafel cart, and we can go out to LAX and shoot at the airport and have baby tigers. And
right.
Tonight's episode, I have to say, even though I'm prominently featured, even if I weren't, it's, I think, one of the funniest shows we've done.
Your favorite episode.
I'm very excited about Year of the Dog. It's really funny.
But it's not, you guys shoot at LAX, but it's not, it doesn't take place here, does it?
No, it takes place in Chicago, but it would be too expensive to go and shoot exteriors in Chicago every week.
Right.
We did a lot of Chicago shooting for the pilot, and I think when we get picked up for our five-year run, you know, we will go back to Chicago and shoot some more.
We need to take a break. We're running a little bit late. The Loop, by the way, Thursday nights, 8:30 on Fox. More with Mimi Rogers.
More Wang talk.
More Wang talk.
Yeah, baby.
With Mimi after this.
This is Dana Gould, and you're listening to The Adam Carolla Show.
Mm-hmm. Mimi Rogers in studio. The Loop, her show Thursday nights, 8:30 on Fox. That's tonight. And the best episode of the year tonight.
That's right. Featuring Mimi Rogers.
That's right. You. It's
Mimi.
All about you,
isn't it, Mimi?
Mimi, someone who's now 50 and still beautiful and seems very comfortable in your own skin. Have you always been that way?
It's better than somebody else's skin.
Yeah, that would be weird.
That would be so weird. Silence of the Lambs.
Yeah.
No, yeah. I mean, I think what it comes down to is I'm a pretty happy person. My kids are sort of what I care about more than anything.
Yeah, and you know, there's a lot of tips about parenting, about reading to your kids or putting them in child seats or something. I think the best thing you can do for your kid is not have a puss on. Be in a good mood around your kid.
Oh, God,
yeah. Don't be a bummer.
Oh, gosh, yeah. I mean, you know, they absorb everything.
Yes.
And they absorb everything that you put out. And, you know, as we've all had that experience where you're driving down the road and the voices from the back seat are throwing everything you've said back at you.
Sure.
Better to say good things and be in a good mood than have your little four-year-old son in the back seat going the C-word, the F-word, the M-word.
But above, you know, having your kids being these little regurgitating your scatological jags, which I'm not going to be able to.
It's the mood thing.
Yes.
It's the attitude thing.
Do not be a bummer.
Don't be a bummer. No one wants to,
you know, when mom is depressed or daddy's depressed, it freaks a kid out.
Yeah, and the next thing you know, they're drinking scotch and, you know, it's bad.
Playing junior college ball over at Valley College, swinging a hammer for a living.
Now, while we're talking about misbehaving, what about this Cruz character?
What about him?
Who is that? You were attached to him at one point. If my notes serve correctly, I've had two
children. I don't remember much other than like the past 10 years.
Nice.
What happened?
You're 9 years old, 8 years older than
seven.
He is or was?
Thank
seven?
You.
Is he 40?
Is he still with us?
He is 43. And I know, yeah, I'm sure you've had an ass full of these questions, though.
Okay, go ahead.
Is he a sane guy? And by the way, he's a guy, and stop me if I'm wrong.
Yeah.
We're just talking about being happy. You know, a lot of guys are like, God, that nut job jumping up on Oprah's sofa.
He sure seems happy.
I just think to myself, well, he just seems like he's in a good mood all the time, and he's excited.
He's an exuberant, intense kind of guy. But check it out. I haven't really hung out with him in about 17 years, so...
But was there a dark side? Was there a quiet side, a reflective side?
I don't remember.
Wow, you're pretty high.
See, I'm one ex-wife removed.
It's true.
I think that puts me in a whole different category.
Yeah. So he was a child in a sense when you guys were married and not the Tom Cruise he is today, perhaps.
Perhaps 17 years ago, yes, he was a bit different.
But you sniffed him out as a kook, though, back then, yes?
I sniffed him out and said, hey, I married the guy. Clearly, I liked him.
Yeah. And this was circa, I don't know, was this Top Gun time?
We started going out when he was shooting Color of Money and Top Gun had not yet come out.
Mm. Yeah, and so he's going to be the hottest guy.
That is what happened.
A lot of pressure, too much for the relationship?
No, I don't think it's ever about that. You know, I think, you know, you start out, you try your best, and sometimes it just doesn't work. I mean, I think we've all been there.
Did you dump him or did he dump you?
You know, it was just the universe saying it's time to move on.
That's enough.
Mamie did the dumping.
Keep in touch.
You know what? I will leave it open to any and all forms of speculation, testicular and otherwise. Because I know Adam likes
weird,
the dog
is
talk.
There weird bad blood? If you saw him, do you call
actually,
him?
We run into each other sometimes, a couple times a year, sometimes a few years go by. When we run into each other, it has been always really pleasant, really friendly. My husband, Chris, he and Tom chatted up, very polite, very friendly. He's been incredibly sweet and gracious to my kids.
Katie Holmes, not born, by the way, when you guys started dating.
Wow. Well, maybe she was 4 or 5. Come on.
Right.
She may have been a kid.
She may have been 4 or 5.
Now, bottom line is you feel bad for Katie Holmes right now.
Do I feel bad for Katie Holmes? Guys, she's having a baby. I'm hoping that this is like the happiest time of her life right now.
Well, keep hoping, Mimi.
But you know better.
You are cynics. You people are cynical.
All right. But last question, straight or gay?
Oh, well, you know what? The last time I made a joke about this, it haunted me for 15 years. I didn't get in trouble. It just would never go away.
Right.
So I'm going to go on the record and say unequivocally that he's straight.
Yes.
Okay?
Because you've been with him in the biblical sense more than
once. I was married to him. I did have sex with him.
Ooh.
So I always find it a little odd when people kind of wink at me and go, so he's gay, right? And I'm like, yeah, I love that in a man.
Yeah.
All the guys I marry are gay. It's like so fabulous.
Let's hope your husband's listening. All right. I want to thank the always candid Mimi Rogers for coming in. The Loop, everybody. Tonight, 8:30, Fox. And this is the best episode ever. Never mind that our beautiful Mimi has the lion's share of the dialogue. This is a great episode, even without you, right?
That's right, baby.
All right, go watch that. Thank you, Mimi, my dear. Come in anytime you like. We will we'll give some thanks where thanks are due. Let's see. Joel McHale, Mimi Rogers, of course. Lisa Tucker from American Idol. Tim McGraw got his special on tomorrow night, 8 o'clock on NBC. And Anita Barone, Blast from the Past. War at Home, Sunday nights, 8:30 on Fox. Lisa Arch, wonderful job with the news today.
Pleasure to be here.
And beyond. And until next time, this is Adam Carolla saying, mahalo.
Mahalo.